Canada. Our energy is Canada. And now, for all the action, let's join our CBC sports crew.
This afternoon from Olympic Stadium in Montreal, it's the Eastern Conference semifinal between the Ottawa Rough Riders and the Montreal Concordes. Riders won both regular season meetings against the Concordes. The ball was bouncing the right way for Ottawa on September 29th at Lansdowne Park as the Rough Rider defensive unit limited Montreal to just 160 yards. Tim McRae was the Rider star in that first meeting, rushing for 67 yards and scoring two touchdowns in a 23-7 win. 3 weeks later, here at Olympic Stadium, Ottawa won again, this time 30-7, and spot back Mike Hudson emerged as the star of the game, catching 10 passes for 102 yards and a touchdown. And that loss, the team's fifth in a row, resulted in a coaching change. Joe Gallant relinquished his dual responsibility, stepping down as coach and turning the reins over to Gary Durchick in his second season as offensive line coach. The change had the desired effect as Montreal won its final two games. On October 27th, with Tony John scoring one touchdown on a 7-yard run and Alan Reid the other on a 60-yard scamper, Montreal clinched the playoff berth, beating Toronto 17-3. And then last week, they came from behind to beat Edmonton 23-20. On the winning touchdown drive late in the fourth quarter, Joe Barnes hit Mike McTagg down the sideline and then fired the winning touchdown strike to Chuck McMahon in the end zone, giving Montreal that all-important home field advantage for today's semifinal against Ottawa. Everybody, a large crowd on a snowy afternoon here at Olympic Stadium for this one-game showdown. And Leo Cahill, does either side have an edge?
I think both have an advantage, Don. I think Ottawa's advantage is psychologically they've won two games this year. As far as Montreal is concerned, they have the home field advantage. That's a good one. Ron, I think it's a toss-up going in.
Well, Leo, I think it's very difficult to defeat a football team three times in a row in any given season. But I know this. Home field advantage, I think, is a little overrated in a one-game shot. But the thing that is important is the playing conditions on that field. And here with us today from Vancouver is Steve Armitage on the sidelines. He'll bring us up to date on those conditions.
Thank you, Ronnie. If you ever had to make a case for artificial turf, this would have been the time to do it. It's been snowing in the Montreal area on and off for the past 2 days. This morning, they simply brought out the snow plows, cleared the snow away, and they're set to go. However, they can't get rid of the cold weather. It's just slightly above freezing. The wind will be a factor, and the field, despite all the work they've done on it, is still wet and slippery. Now let's meet the two teams that will play under these conditions in the CFL's Eastern semifinal. The Montreal Concordes and the Ottawa Rough Riders.
Voici maintenant l'alignement partant en défensive pour les Rough Riders d'Ottawa. Introducing Ottawa Rough Riders starting defensive lineup. Le numéro 79. Left end, ailier à gauche, Jeff Roberts. halfback, Demi Rao Dixon. That side, 25, halfback, Demi Ricky Barden.
Have been introduced here at Olympic Stadium in Montreal, and the reaction is one that certainly was predictable. A loud chorus of boos for the Ottawa Rough Riders. Now let's meet the Montreal Concordes.
Leading offensive lineup. Psych outfit, 58. Sauve, center, Glenn Kibo. Is 66. Galagos, left guard, Lloyd Fairbanks. Sagotia, 54. Galadwat, right guard, Rob Smith. Wassar, 60. Bloc Galagos, left tackle, Blake Neal.
In two games outscored Montreal 53-14, but Joe Barnes was not in the lineup the 0 for one of those games.
Well, and there's no question in my mind that Joe Barnes is going to have to be the catalyst again today if Montreal is going to win. Now, Joe hasn't been too consistent this year at getting his team in the end zone. There's bad field conditions down there today. I think that he's got to use his two running backs. I think he's smart enough to do that. He can take the rush. Over on the defensive side, I think they're going to swarm J.C. Watts. And I think you're going to find that the guy that's going to be really tough out there this afternoon is a guy by the name of Steve Rocky, number 99. He's the guy that's going to be in the backfield. He does take chances, though, coming on the inside occasionally. Watts can roll out to the outside and get outside, and we'll have to watch that this afternoon. What about Ottawa, Ron?
Well, Leo, I think you're exactly right when you talk about the Montreal defense. The coach said yesterday they want to put pressure on that quarterback, J.C. Watts. The main reason, he has been very inconsistent this year. He's thrown 25 interceptions, and he's a lot like that kid that when he's good, he's very, very good, and when he's bad, he's awful. And he's had that type of season. He just hasn't had things going his way. So JC's got to be consistent today for Ottawa to win, and they've got to get a great effort again from that front four on defense. They have 27 sacks as a unit, but their leader's been Lloyd Lewis, who's moved into the defensive tackle spot because of Jeff Roberts coming to the defensive end position. Lewis has been the leader with 9.5 quarterback sacks. It's their job to make Joe Barnes inconsistent today. That's what they want to do. Anyway, the kickoff's about ready to go, but first let's go back to Brian Williams at CFL Control.
Thank you, Ron. Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to our control studios in Toronto. With me is Hamilton quarterback Ken Hobart, the outstanding player in the Eastern Conference. You will meet one of these two teams next week. You agree with Ron and Leo that the key to this football game is indeed J.C. Watts.
I think so. I think J.C. is the key, but I think more importantly than J.C. is the people up front. If Montreal can put pressure on J.C. and force him to scramble around and throw some balls up that he doesn't want to, I think if they can do that, they'll be successful.
You had a big win in Ottawa a couple of weeks ago. Watts, to me, seemed rattled in that football game.
I think so. Our people up front, Grover Covington and company, put some pressure on him, forced him to throw some balls that he shouldn't have thrown. And he just tried to do some things he shouldn't have done, and that was the key to our success.
All right, we've got to go. A quick prediction.
I'll take Montreal, and that Barnes has experience there at home. I would rather play Montreal in a way, but I think, Ottawa, but I think Montreal will win.
All right, there's the prediction from Kenny Hobart. We'll see if you're right at halftime. At halftime, more from Ken Hobart, who will play one of these two teams next week. Also coming up at halftime, a profile of the Canadian Legion as it celebrates its 60th anniversary tomorrow. And we'll run down Grey Cup preparations in Montreal. Stay with us. The opening kickoff is up next for the Eastern semifinal as CFL 85 continues.
Well, as Steve pointed out at the start of the telecast, it's a cool afternoon here in Montreal. The temperature right at the freezing mark. And the snow that was falling earlier this morning has stopped, although they are projecting more snow flurries later this afternoon. So it would appear that winter has arrived here in the province of Quebec. It has definitely arrived in other parts of the country, particularly out west, where it will be a chilly afternoon for that western semifinal featuring Winnipeg and Edmonton. Rick Ryan will be kicking off for the Montreal Concordes to Kevin Gray and Mike Catterbone. Joe Moss, the head coach of the Ottawa Rough Riders, who was fined $2,000 for moving out onto the playing field in his team's final game of regular season play against the British Columbia Lions. Harrison takes the kickoff, and he is hit immediately. He is dropped at the 30-yard line by George Smith. So that's where the Ottawa Rough Riders will scrimmage first and 10 at kickoff by Rick Ryan, traveling 44 yards.
Well, we know J.C. Watts is the quarterback. Tim McCray gets the opportunity to play because of an injury to Lester Brown. Jim Reed always plays a big part. Mike Catterbone with 5 touchdown receptions leads to a touchdown at the offensive line. Nick Benjamin, Shelley Award nominee, rookie of the year. 2 all-star offensive tackles got their work cut out for them.
J.C. Watts throwing down the sidelines, and the pass is complete to Stu Fraser. He takes it out of bounds for a first down at the 46-yard line.
I was really impressed last week with this defensive line. As I said before, I think a guy that's going to be a catalyst in there will be Steve Rocky, but Brett Williams and Scott have played exceptionally well in there. George Smith is also playing well. The linebackers, they have the experience in there now. And the deep backs is as good a defensive secondary as anyone, a lot of people think, so defense should be okay.
Pass is incomplete. It was intended for Bruce. By Vince Faison, it will be second and 10.
You know, Don, an interesting thing, you're talking about Joe Moss being fined $2,000. They had poor boxes throughout the dressing room, and the players all threw in money. I hear that they come up with that $2,000.
Would Joe players have reacted the same way for you if you would have been fined in your days with the Argos?
They'd have sealed the box.
They would.
Watts gets away from the initial charge. He throws, completing the pass. It's fumbled, and they rule incomplete pass. It appeared as though Clad Jemison had it, but when he came down, he apparently did not have control, and they're ruling an incomplete pass.
As the young man on the sidelines, Gary Durchick, the head coach of the Montreal team, as we see JC looking downfield just before crossing the line of scrimmage, throwing the ball, but it was called incomplete. But Gary Durchick, relatively unknown a couple weeks ago, now assuming the responsibility as head coach of the Concordes.
Harry Skipper and Jeff Patterson are back for this third down kick by Ken Clark. He led the CFL in punting this season. And his kicking could be a factor favoring the Ottawa Rough Riders today. Harry Skipper on this return gets an opening. Still on his feet. And he gets back to the 46.
Concordes as a defensive back, but he can also do this very well. Excellent balance, picks up his blockers well, makes a great return on this, and this is a big shot in the arm for the Concordes having this kind of field position right now.
For their first offensive series, they are first and 10 from the 46-yard line of Ottawa. Alan Reed picks up 2 yards. He got inside the 45 and is stopped by all-star linebacker Rick Sovieta. Skipper out of Southern California, or South Carolina, I should say. And he is still in the negotiating stage as far as his future with the Montreal Concordes is concerned. He has had some ongoing discussions with Joe Galat regarding next year. Barnes flips it out to Araki, but he'll be stopped short of the first down, tripped up by Tom Towns. At the 39-yard line, so it will be 3rd and 3 for Montreal.
I really believe if they're going to be successful today, they've got to get Nick Araki into this offense. And we've said this time and time again this year, every team that's been successful against the Concordes has removed that man, and he's been no factor in the ballgame. I think for Montreal to win, he has got to play a big role. Nick Araki is just too good a receiver to neglect.
I think they're varying his patterns too around. They're trying to get him straight downfield a lot. They were knocking him down, cutting him down, hitting him and everything else. Now he's throwing those crossing patterns to him, and he can get open on these. And when he catches that short pass, he can run away from people with his strength.
Roy Kurtz with the field goal attempt, 47 yards, and it falls short. And it's brought out of the end zone. Ricky Barton on an excellent return. He could go all the way. Tripped up, but not before he got to the 34-yard line of the Montreal Concordes. A great punt return by Harry Skipper and a field goal return by Ricky Barton. And we've got a timeout here at Olympic Stadium. A 76-yard return by Ricky Barton. And the Ottawa Rough Riders now have great field position.
You know, Don, in a game like this, it's those big plays that can make the difference. And turnabout's fair play here. Skipper had a long return, and now Ricky Barton another. We'll see if JC can do anything with this thing.
It's still scoreless in this first quarter. The pitch goes to Tim McRae. He was tripped up immediately. And that was Steve Rocky, the man you referred to in our pregame show, Leo, as a key figure in that Montreal defensive unit.
Yeah, and I noticed Steve Rocky again that time. He takes the liberty of taking the inside a lot of times. He did that time also, made the play, but that's dangerous because J.C. Watts can step outside of him.
Second and 10. Watts will try and put it in the air. He gets away from the initial pressure. Now he's looking for that first down as he runs the ball, but he is going to be stopped about 3, maybe 4 yards short by Paul Gray. He hesitated just that fraction of a second that enabled those Montreal defenders to get over there and prevent him from going for first down yardage.
Well, in JC's defense, what he wanted to do was try to get in behind Nick Benjamin, and the offensive line was coming out to help him. But when he stopped like that, as you say, he lost his momentum and then couldn't get his speed back up, and they're going to come up 3 yards short.
They came with a stunt on the outside, too. They set the defensive tackle out, Racky inside of him. Racky got in there and made a lot of penetration, but Watts did get outside of him.
Dean Dorsey will be attempting the field goal from 33 yards out. kick is good, and the Ottawa Roughriders come up with the first scoring statistic of this Eastern Conference semifinal, a 33-yard field goal by Dean Dorsey. That comes with 10:18 remaining in the opening quarter.
Well, you said that turnabout was fair play, you know, on those two big returns, and one team capitalized and kicks 3 points, the other team gets nothing, and, you know, in games like this, every point's important.
Ron, I think that the first team to score a touchdown is going to have an advantage in this ball game too. Psychologically, if it's Ottawa, Montreal, I think we'll remember those two big wins Ottawa has. And if it's Montreal that scores, they'll think that, well, maybe we can win this football game.
Chris Haynes will be very close to the first down at the 45-yard line, taking that throw from quarterback Joe Barnes. He was brought down to the artificial turf here at Olympic Stadium by Ralph Dixon.
That's another part of Montreal's game that they've finally got some work on. Get the ball to the wide receivers, because that's going to help Araki inside. If you don't get the ball outside, you can knock Araki around inside. But that's a good way to start it. Let them know that we'll throw it out there.
This would be a good opportunity, as you often say, Ron, for a little play action, second and inches. But Barnes gives to Johns, and he is stopped and driven back. I don't believe he got the first down.
In a game like this, you know, Don, I think, as you pointed out, that that play-action pass would have been an excellent call right there, but everyone is so intent on making that first down that they go to the standard play, and Ottawa just held up tough that time.
I see this, but I don't really believe it. They're going to punt the football. I'll tell you what, when you're in a football game and you need less than a yard and you don't make the third down yardage to make that first down to keep a drive alive, you're in trouble. And when you kick the ball with like 18 inches, it looks like down there to me, you're in trouble.
Well, Gary Dirksen, you know, he's a coach that came up from the States. And if you notice the National Football League games, anytime they've got this kind of a situation, they kick the football. But when you're a yard off the line of scrimmage in Canada and you've got less than a yard to go, you've got to go for it.
Mike McTagg's kick goes to Ricky Barton. Here's another good run back. At least it appeared to be developing before he was tripped up by Mike Emery. And we have 8:57 remaining in this opening quarter. Yes, indeed, the Royal Winter Fair Horse Show, one of the outstanding events taking place in Toronto, and you'll see it next weekend on Sports Weekend. I'm still a little surprised, and I agree with you, Ron, that the Montreal Concordes punted on third down and inches. Scott has J.C. Watts, and he is dropped for a loss.
Well, Doug Scott's been the leader for that Montreal Concord defense up front. 12 and a half quarterback sacks on the year. And talking to Dursic, Coach Dursic the other day, he was been really impressed with the play of Doug Scott over the year. And there you see him make the sack on J.C. And this is the key. They've got to rattle J.C. Watts somehow.
Ron, after looking at them last week and watching their defensive front four, Williams and Scott and Rocky and those guys coming in there, J.C. Watts, I don't think is going to be effective in a straight drop back type of attack. I think he's going to have to roll and get to the outside, buy some time.
Swinging it out to Timmy McRae. He cuts back inside, dodges a couple of tacklers, but is going to be stopped short of the first down as he fought his way to the 41.
You know what I mean, Ron? On the as far as J.C. Watts is concerned, he tries to drop back. He's not a classic drop back passing type guy. And I think that Montreal's inside defense on their front four is going to have the pressure to get in and get in his face on this. I think he's going to have to get the outside.
If J.C. wants to drop back, he's got to take the quick drops and throw it quick. He's not, as you say, classic to go back, sit in the pocket, and throw it. His strength's always been get outside and run with that football. And I know that that's what Joe Moss wants him to do.
I think that's a good point, that if he's going to drop back, to throw it in a hurry, because if he takes any time, he's too short, and they get in his face.
Don't make the fun of short people.
They came very close to blocking that third down kick by Ken Clark. Harry Skipper picks it up on the sidelines, fumbles the football, but he was out of bounds at the 37-yard line. Ron Engelson had a grip on the Montreal Concord punt return man, cornerback Harry Skipper.
Well, that's a good place to kick the football. Always kick the football to the sidelines when they're, you know, and the bigger the game, the more important it is. And get it over there where you can pin him in on a sideline. Don't give him room to roam.
Rick Ryan was the man who was coming from the outside and attempted to block that third down punt by Ken Clark. First and 10. Concords are at their own 38 and a half yard line. inside fake by Barnes to the sidelines, and the pass is incomplete. It was intended for Mike McTagg, and Dixon was covering.
That wasn't too well timed. The execution was off a little because Joe Barnes gives the good play-action fake, which you need to do on first down, but McTagg was open before Joe was ready to throw, and by the time he got the ball there, Dixon had recovered. That's good defense.
That's why in practice that you've got to spend so much time with your passer and your pass receiver, because when you're coming off of a bootleg fake like that, as you say, if the receiver breaks it too quickly, it's just ineffective.
Penalty flag is down, and Barnes is being chased, and he'll be caught. Lloyd Lewis is the man who caught up with him. There was a flag at the line of scrimmage and also one in the Montreal backfield. It appeared as though Michel Bourgeau may have jumped offside.
Well, it's too bad because that is an excellent effort by Lloyd Lewis to sack Joe Barnes for a big loss. Well, we'll see what the referees have to say.
Ross Ferrier from Scarborough, Ontario is the man in charge of this afternoon's officiating crew. And to the delight of the fans at Olympic Stadium, he marches off the yardage against Ottawa. Face mask as well, charged against Ottawa, but right now let's join Steve Armitage on the sideline.
Don, we mentioned at the beginning of the game that there had been a lot of snow on the field earlier this morning. They managed to get rid of most of it, but the field is still very slippery and wet. I've been talking to the players about any kind of special footwear that they're wearing, and they all say no, they're going with their normal turf shoes. Don?
All right, thanks, Steve. And you won't have to worry about weather conditions next Sunday afternoon when we're under the dome in Vancouver for that Western Conference Final, the BC Lions against either Winnipeg or Edmonton. They'll decide an opponent for Don Matthews' crew later today at Winnipeg Stadium.
Well, talking to the Montreal coaches before the game, they said, especially on this kind of a field, that they're going to be using their running backs a lot. That puts a lot of emphasis on that inside running game on middle linebacker Al Washington, and he's done a good job all year and did a good job on that last play. He's the guy that's going to be stopping those tackle-to-tackle runs.
Alan Reed, the ball carrier on that last play, second and six. The pass complete to Araki. It'll be very close to a first down, depending on where they spot the ball. Rick Sovieta, an all-star linebacker, against the all-star Eastern Conference spot back, Nick Araki. Early in the year, the Montreal Concordes had great success when they were able to get the ball to Araki, but Hamilton, in back-to-back games with Montreal, took Araki away from the Montreal offensive scheme, and other clubs copied that defensive pattern that Hamilton employed.
Well, you see, they swing the back out to one side, hope to get the defense out of there, and then allow Araki to have a little bit of room to work, which he did, and he is a big, big target, but they're a little bit short, but they got to get this one.
Yeah, it's third down, I should say, and just 6 inches to go, and I'm sure that Joe Barnes is going to come in here as wily as he is with the quarterback sneak. He's been around long enough to know that this is the play for here.
Barnes keeps. He gets to midfield. He's got the first down. Times this year in those short yardage situations, Montreal has given the ball to Tony Johns, but teams seem to be aware of that fact as well.
Well, as Leo said, 6 inches to go, the fewer people touch that ball, the better. Let that quarterback get it. Joe's been around long enough to know that.
First and 10, the ball is at midfield. Ottawa leads by a score of 3-0 with 4:50 remaining in this opening quarter. Joe Barnes setting up the screen to Tony Johns. He gets a couple of blocks. He's got another first down.
You know, Don, these are great plays for a field like it is today, a little bit slippery and wet. Throw those screen passes against a team that's playing the zone defense. Watch those linebackers. They're dropping out of there. Now, those linemen are coming on a charge. It's very difficult for them to stop and turn back. If you've got the blockers out in front of them, that's what you want to get something going. It's the first down.
This is one thing that Joe Barnes should be able to do better than a young quarterback, and that's kind of read that defense, and on a day like today, take advantage of what's going to work.
Barnes dropping back, and he is dropped as Jeff Roberts, along with Lloyd Lewis, fresh captured the Montreal quarterback, and they dropped him. He did not have a chance to set up the throw.
Well, this is one of those times that Joe Barnes did read the defense. They put the blitz on him. He wants to throw it quick, and he's covered. You see what happens. Number 79, Jeff Roberts, just shoved that offensive tackle right back into Joe Barnes.
Yeah, Roberts and Lewis, it wasn't so much the blitz as it was that they just overpowered those offensive linemen for the Concord, and that's what they did in the last couple ball games too. That front four just prevailed.
Second and 17. They just blew Trevor Bowles back into quarterback Joe Barnes. The pass, is it a catch? Yes, they are ruling a reception at the 36-yard line. That will be about a yard short of a first down.
Well, that's the way you time that pattern. Boy, Chris Haynes came down and feel like he was going to try to blow right by Kevin Gray. And at the last minute, he ran a turn in pattern, and Barnes delivered it early. It was low, but it was a great catch. Well, right. I think it was a catch, Will.
Well, right here, it looks like to me that it may be a little bit more than a yard, maybe a yard and a half. They've got a third down here, but they're going to go for it this time. They've got better field position. I think at this stage of the ball game, it's a good time to show that you can do something.
Confidence builder.
They get the ball to Tony Johns for a first down. This is one of the key changes that Gary Gerchuk made when taking over from Joe Gallad as head coach. He took the rookie out of Henderson State, Tony Johns, and gave him a job as a starter. Throughout the year, he had been employed mainly as a backup as they went with two imports in those running back positions.
Well, they always give it to him in short yardage. That play like that does a lot for your offensive line. Don't let that other guy overpower you. That's what offensive defense, Ottawa's defense has done. Show him that you can knock him out of there when you need it.
First and 10 from the 34. The pass is complete to Allen Reed. Reed getting to the outside. Chris Sigler takes him out of bounds, but it's another Montreal first down.
Well, when they got out of the one-on-one situation there, we're going to see it right here. Sigler was the only guy within 10 yards of him, and Sigler just kind of stalked him a little bit, made sure he took the inside cut away from him and forced him out of bounds. It was a good play, even if it was a very substantial gain by Sigler.
As you say, Neil, they had that blitz on. When they blitz, that put Sigler on him man-to-man. He can't get up there fast enough when that deep in the secondary, and Barnes found it. That's the last man. I think he's going to score if he misses him.
Yeah, he did an excellent job of not overplaying his hand, but just stalking him and staying on balance and got him out of bounds and saved the touchdown.
Well, this is something we have not seen Montreal do too often in the last few weeks, is sustained drive. They've got a pretty good one going here. Of course, they're looking for 6 points. They don't want it to stall before they cross that Ottawa goal line. And 2 minutes and 16 seconds is the time remaining in this opening quarter. It's a 3-0 game. Ottawa in front on a 33-yard field goal by Dean Dorsey. Montreal with a definite edge offensively. They have already picked up 6 first downs compared to just 1 for Ottawa. First down pass to the sideline, intended for McTagg, and Dixon was there to knock it away.
Excellent job by Dixon. There you see Gary Gerchuk on the sidelines. He's a clone of a lot of the coaches that came from what they call the cradle of the coaches, Miami of Ohio. There's been a lot of excellent coaches come out of there. Era Parsegan, Johnny Pont, Paul Dietzel, John McVay. You can go on. And this guy is just like them. He's a very studious type. He's the type of guy that can organize. And although you haven't heard of him, I think you may hear of him in the future.
Second and 10 from the 17. Barnes dumps it off. Allen Reed slips at the 15-yard line as Dixon came up. Make sure he stayed down.
So you get an example of the problem with the field. What's Joe? He wants to throw quick, and you'll see coming from the left side, the defensive end is free. So he dumps it. Watch his feet go out from under him. And that's the problem. That's why those defensive backs can't overcommit, nor your receivers make that real quick turn on that icy part that they're in right now, the field.
You know, the funny thing, Ron, when you think about this thing, is the way it looks like the Ottawa team is overpowering the offensive line for the Montreal Concord.
Roy Kurtz with the 22-yard field goal, and it is good. And we've got a tie ball game at Olympic Stadium with 1 minute and 10 seconds remaining in the opening quarter of this Eastern Conference semifinal.
I want to come back and tell you about that in a minute.
Open
opening quarter, and the Ottawa Rough Riders employing a bit of strategy here. They are asking Montreal to kick off because that chore is being handled by Rick Ryan, and he is unable to kick the ball very deep. And Kevin Gray takes it on this kickoff return. Penalty flags go down as well. The ball fumbled and picked up by Montreal.
I think you're going to find that it may be a face guard because there was a couple of quick grabs in the head area as he was making his play with the football.
Said that Rick Ryan is kicking off. Montreal made that decision in practice this week because Roy Kurtz, who handles the place kicking chores, has an injury that has been bothering him throughout the season, and it particularly hampers him on kickoffs. So as a result, that chore has fallen to Ryan, but he has not had success in getting that ball deep, and now with that penalty, the field position improves.
Snap. Montreal number 77. First down.
Well, as I referred before, it looked like they took a couple swipes. There you see it right there. They did grab him by the face mask, and that was unfortunate for Montreal after the recovery. But it's a penalty against Montreal for grabbing the face mask.
Mark Hopkins was the guilty party. It's first and 10. Ottawa from the 54-yard line. Watts completes to Stu Fraser. And Fraser has a first down to the 32-yard line of Montreal. 30 seconds remaining in the quarter. Steve Armitage.
Don, we had a technical problem here at the Olympic Stadium, but it wasn't our problem. It happened to belong to the Montreal Concordes. Their spotting phones weren't working on the sidelines to coach Gary Durkic, so they asked the Ottawa Rough Riders to unplug their phones. However, the phones are working now, and both benches are in touch with their spotters upstairs. Don?
That's pretty nifty. I've never seen that before. I've seen it the other way around, but usually if the home team has the trouble with the phones...
J.C. Watts running the ball very effectively for a first down at the 16-yard line. And that is also the final play of the opening quarter. But with the score tied at 3, the Ottawa Rough Riders are now in position to regain the lead once more. We'll be back after this. The Ottawa Rough Riders will be first and 10. This second quarter, and they have put together a pretty good drive, and Joe Moss has to be pleased with the way J.C. Watts is running that football.
Well, that's what Joe said yesterday at the press conference. You've got to get consistency from J.C. in order for them to be successful, no matter who they're playing. And in a game like today with a slippery field, I think the advantage goes to a guy like Watts, who's got the good balance and can make those cuts on that wet field.
Next Sunday, we'll be at Vancouver for that Western Final, the BC Lions against either Winnipeg or Edmonton. And for all you football fans in the Vancouver area, we understand that about 7,500 tickets for that game are still available. They're available at all the usual ticket outlets on the West Coast. Stu Fraser was the intended receiver, being covered by Harry Skipper.
Fooled him a little bit. I think J.C. Watts expected a man-to-man coverage, and they ran a crossing pattern going to hit Fraser quick in the flat, and all of a sudden Harry Skipper come out of nowhere and just cut him down. That's what you got to do. Don't let the quarterback know what's going, so as soon as he figures you out, he's going to beat you.
I think down here where you can use the three downs, that they ought to take advantage of a guy like Tim McCray and let him have the football instead of using that drop back pass all the time.
J.C. Watts is in trouble. Again, he gets away from Doug Scott and dumps it off. Touchdown, Stu Fraser.
This is just an excellent job by J.C. Watts of using his eyes. He runs a bootleg pattern. Nothing on that side. We're going to see him make the fake, come out on the bootleg pattern, looking to the right side. Nothing there. Uses his speed, his agility, as Ron said. And watch Steve Rocky, number 99 there, commit himself to the inside, give up the contain, and allow Watts to have that little bit more time to get the ball to Fraser for the touchdown.
Dean Dorsey will now attempt the point after out of the hold by Ken Clark, and he puts it through. So the Ottawa Rough Riders have regained the lead on the touchdown by Stu Fraser. And we'll be back with the Ottawa kickoff after this. Stu Fraser, a product of the University of New Brunswick, scoring the touchdown for the Ottawa Rough Riders. And they now kick off. Vince Faison from his own 7-yard line, working to the sidelines and running out of room. Al Washington took him into touch with help from Kevin Gray, and it will be first and 10 from the 24.
Well, you see JC sprinting to his left. Now, somebody makes a big mistake when they leave the man open, come up and try to force Watson. You see Stu Fraser by himself. He hurt his ankle a little bit. Can't afford to lose him.
Time these teams met at Olympic Stadium. Slotback Mike Hudson was the star of the game. Fraser has replaced Hudson at that slotback position this afternoon, and he has already grabbed 3 passes, including that touchdown throw from J.C. Watts. Nick Araki grabs a Joe Barnes toss for a Montreal first down, getting out to the 35.
A little meeting going on with the defensive crew over there.
You know, the point that I was making before, Ron, is that this defensive line is handling Montreal, where against Hamilton, Hamilton just handles Ottawa, and different teams play differently against those other teams, and it's a coincidence that this can happen in the game.
Barnes for Chris Haynes, first down at the 52.
Well, they're putting 3 receivers to one side of the field and getting Chris Haynes isolated on Kevin Gray. Watch Joe throw the ball. You'll see nothing underneath. No problem. Just come back and catch the football, which he does. Now, you see Chris Siegler get a little upset because he couldn't get over there to help him. That's a long way to go.
That slippery field doesn't help when you try to plant and get there in a hurry.
Well, that's the 3rd reception for Chris Haynes. Earlier in the year, there were games where they didn't even throw 3 passes in an entire game to the wide receiver. Joe Barnes comes back across the middle. He was looking for Tony Johns as his path to the outside had been blocked off by Jeff Roberts.
Jeff Roberts did an excellent job as a defensive end. He just stayed at home. He says, you're not going to get outside. And he forced him to pull up. And in turn, now Barnes has to look for another receiver to throw to. But his primary receivers were where he was going, outside. Couldn't get there.
You know, Ron, there was a time where Greg Marshall was the dominant factor in that front four. But today, so far, Jeff Roberts and Lloyd Lewis have been overpowering.
Lewis has been a great addition this year to that Ottawa front four. He has led the team in sacks. Marshall is the man after Barnes. Now it's Roberts, and Roberts gets him. He was flushed out of there initially by Greg Marshall and then chased down by Jeff Roberts.
The name of the game in Canadian football is speed, and you can get a big defensive end as big and strong as that guy is to run down quarterbacks from the inside out like he did that time. You've got yourself a pretty good defense.
Well, Roberts does have the size, 6'3", 235 pounds. He's out of Tulane, and he certainly showed a burst of speed in chasing down Joe Barnes that time. Stu Fraser and Mike Catterbone are back for this third down kick. Kick by McTagg. It is taken by Catterbone at the 15-yard line. And Catterbone runs it back to the 23. A 43-yard kick that time by Mike McTagg. A run back of 8 by Catterbone. And it will be Ottawa first and 10 when we return. Bring with head coach Gary Gerchuk as the Montreal defensive unit will now attempt to stop the Ottawa Rough Riders, who lead by 7. J.C. Watts to Stu Fraser. That will be another first down. Well, they had success getting the ball to the slot back the last time they met here at Olympic Stadium. They're enjoying similar success this afternoon.
Well, Mike Hudson was the guy last time we were here. He's got a hamstring injury, and Stu Fraser steps in like, you know, hey, I've done this all my life. And that's what you got to have in these kind of games.
The ball will indicate to you that there's something about that one position there that Montreal doesn't defend too well.
Well, whoever plays there has success. I'd have to agree with that.
Five completions for J.C. Watt. Four of them have gone to Stu Fraser. All sorts of movement at the line of scrimmage. Penalty flags fly. It will be a time count violation against the Ottawa Rough Riders. Well, the Ottawa Rough Riders have designs of being here at Olympic Stadium for the Grey Cup game on November 24th. But even if they aren't here, Bill Holdsworth, the Ottawa PR director, informs that the Rough Riders will have a special Grey Cup package for the big game. The trip will include return transportation and a game ticket. Interested fans can call the Rough Rider ticket office for more information.
Violation, Ottawa number 6. First down repeated.
First and 15 for Ottawa. The ball is at the 32. Catterbone comes wide to the right. They actually send four receivers up to the right side. J.C. Watt won't get the ball to them as Doug Scott made sure of that.
What they did on that play right there, Ron, they put their whole formation to the right side. They split end out to the left side, went into one-on-one situation, thought that they were going to, we'll see J.C. Watts go to the left there, thought that they were going to get an isolation over there, and they zoned it on that side, which amounted to almost a double coverage, and there just wasn't any place to throw it. He had to beat the football.
And as they say, the best pass defense is good pass rush. Can't throw if you don't have time.
10:20 is the time remaining in the half. 10-3 is the score. Ottawa leading Montreal. Swinging it to Tim McRae coming out of that backfield. He breaks one tackle but does not get away from Steve Rocky. Tim McRae in that running back position replacing Lester Brown, who had played very well for Ottawa in the last few games but came down with an injury in the final outing of the season against the BC Lions.
You know, with Tim McRae and Lester Brown in an offensive backfield would be something to see, but you know what? How do you take Jim Reed out of there? He does everything they ask of him. He doesn't get much credit, but everybody knows this. If he's getting time to throw and they're making yards, he's blocking.
Especially in this emphasis game on the throwing game, you've got to have that fullback that can block.
Ken Clark is punting. It's blocked. The ball is picked up by Harry Skipper, and Harry Skipper is still on his feet but going nowhere at the 52-yard line.
Take a look at this. It was a miracle how the ball got downfield because the penetration was right in on Clark. He gets the ball away. The defender coming in there blocked the ball, but it did get downfield.
I don't know if we'll see the penalty infraction, but I'll tell you what, it is amazing. The ball in the downfield, you still have to give yards on it once it crossed that line of scrimmage. And that 15-yard unnecessary roughness doesn't help either.
Field position for Montreal. First and 10. They are at the 37. They trail by 7. Barnes to Araki. First down to the 10-yard line. Right now, let's bring in Steve Armitage.
Thank you, John. Steve Rocky just came off the field a few moments ago, favoring his left shoulder. I asked him if he hurt it on that last play. He said yes, but he wasn't seeking any medical help. He'll stay in the game despite the sore shoulder.
Well, this is a great job here by Joe Barnes rolling to his left. And he almost gets forced out of bounds at the last minute, looks downfield, gets Araki. Watch Araki run into this defender. Boom, knocks him right back on his back.
Well, when you're 6'6", 236 pounds, you can challenge some of those defensive backs, and that's what Nick Araki did. The pass to Reed, he one-handed that throw, and he would have been better off if he had just let it go because he lost yards.
Well, I was thinking it was a great catch by Reed, because what happens so many times is when you jump in the air with one hand, with wet gloves or something, that ball slides off, and that could be going the other way, because what's the catch? If he deflects this ball, goes right into number 22 Dixon's hands, and he's got a clear road ahead of him.
Second and 11. Barnes into the end zone. Oh, it was intended for McTagg.
Boy, McTagg got all by himself in the end zone. No one there.
catchable football.
Up in the right of the screen, I don't think we'll see it, but boy, Nick Araki was having, he's having a heck of an argument with a couple of people there because they just grabbed him and threw him on the ground at the goal line, and then the guy came across and turned upfield and got open and couldn't hold on to the ball. But Araki was not too happy when he got up off the ground.
Well, the Montreal Concordes aren't too happy as a team. They thought they were going to culminate this drive by putting that ball into the end zone, but that Joe Barnes throw intended for McTagg, and the receiver could not hang on, so Kurtz with the field goal attempt, it is good. And with 7:34 remaining in this first half, it's now 10-6, the Ottawa Rough Riders leading Montreal in the Eastern Conference semifinal. Following in the footsteps of the man he replaced, Joe Galat, who was always nappily attired, not only at the press conferences, but also on the sidelines. Mike McTagg replacing Ryan for that kickoff, and Catterbone returned it to the 45-yard line.
You know, one thing, Don, is Montreal better hope they don't have to kick off too many times because if they're not getting that ball down the field. Look at this, a field position at the 45-yard line. Boy, you already got great field position to start.
I think Ottawa is going to persist in having Montreal kick off at every opportunity following field goals and touchdowns. I hope not too many touchdowns will be scored, of course. This pass is intercepted by Gray.
Ever saw him. You see number 42 go back and just reach his left hand over there, hook it in, and that does a pretty good job of running with the football.
But it takes a great hit from number 65 right there. Roger Catlin didn't even slow him down. I tell you, Paul Gray is an excellent linebacker, and he sits off the line deep, and that helped him on that particular play.
Now, first and 10 from the 40-yard line. Way over the head of Chris Haynes.
There we saw an example of what we talked about earlier. Haynes is going down the field. He knows he's going to go down and break to the sideline, and there was just no way that Lamont Meacham could make the cut and get back fast enough. Barnes just threw it over his head.
And Joe Barnes, being the veteran quarterback that he is, has got to take advantage of these opportunities when they do come and get more points on the board. Now, they've got a couple field goals, but Joe's got to get him in the end zone.
J.C. Watts had 25 passes intercepted this season. Joe Barnes had 23 intercepted. They were 1-2 in that category. Alan Reed takes the swing pass, gets a block. He's got a burst of speed for a first down. When he accelerates, he moves.
That's what was impressive about that. It wasn't a big deal as far as a little dump off to the back goes, but he took one look upfield and saw McTagg, and he also saw a Recky. Now watch when he catches the ball. He sees the two red jerseys, and he just says, I'm going to split them. Good job by Araki shielding one, and bang, the acceleration is there, and he got the big gain in the first down. And as Leo said, they've got to take advantage of this and put it in the end zone.
From the 25, it's first and 10. The draw play with Tony Johns. He picks up about 3 yards before being stopped. Washington and Sovieta all stop Tony Johns.
Well, we've seen Barnes throw a couple balls off the money, but in defense of him, he did throw the ball well enough into the end zone for Mike McTagg to have one touchdown. Now he's working on another one.
5:20 is the time remaining. It's second and 7. The ball is at the 21-yard line. Play in the first half in this semifinal game. Tony Johns takes that swing pass. He'll be into first down territory, depending on where they spot the ball.
Well, he got the man-to-man coverage. He wanted in the secondary, and he just swings Tony Johns out there, and that puts him on Rick Sovieta. Really no contest. The back's going to outrun that linebacker most of the time.
They're going to measure this one as the chain is brought out, and they have to go all the way across the field. But offensively, This is a much improved Montreal football team than the one we saw in late September and early October.
Not much doubt about it, is there? I think confidence has a lot to do with it, too. This football team was playing under a lot of duress in those weeks when they were having some tough times and some injuries, and there was a lot of pressure on their head coach, Joe Gallant. I think the people feel now that with the new coach in there and a guy that really doesn't have that much background and so on as far as pressure is concerned, that they can play a little looser, and they're doing it.
There's an interesting statistic. 12 first downs for Montreal, 4 for Ottawa. First and 10. The ball is at the 14-yard line. Barnes to the sideline. Haynes makes the catch. Another first down.
Well, you can tell one thing. Chris Haynes wasn't used a lot early in the year, but he knows what to do as a receiver. He had a linebacker between him and Joe Barnes, and he just came back to the sideline, got away from him, and Barnes hit him, turned it into a big play.
Well, right now, Ron, they're down there at about the 3-yard line. We'll see Joe Barnes again roll out here. He gets outside and contains just enough to get the ball off. As you say, Chris Haynes worked back to it. Excellent job. But right here, they should be using their running attack now. They've got 3 tries at the goal line.
First and goal from the 3. They go to the ground game with Alan Reed. He stopped right at the line of scrimmage.
Boy, that Ottawa defense is tough.
They're not going to run too far as long as they line up and take a shot at Lloyd Lewis at his defensive tackle position.
I think one more thing, Don, too, is that when you line up with just one back in the backfield without any deception at all and then run with the football, you're not giving your offense the credit that they deserve. You got to have 2 guys in the backfield. If one is the lead blocker or one is the guy that you're going to fake to in order to have effective running down there.
Second and goal from the 3. The pitch to Tony Johns. He'll get in.
That looks a little bit more like it. They've got a 3 back in the backfield. They use 2 of them as personal interference. They look like pulling guys leading them back to the outside. But they're tossed to the outside for the touchdown.
Well, what they do is they steal the inside, kick out the outside, and Tony Johns just takes the team that they create. Do it in very easy. You say, Leo, those backs went out there like forward guards. Let's take a look at it. All right, the pop has come back to Johns. You'll see the personal interference. Outside of bang, here into the end zone, and McMahon's already standing there waiting on it. He could have gone an awful long way.
Roy Kurtz will now attempt the point after to give Montreal the lead for the first time in the game. That comes with 3:41 remaining in this opening half. 13-10, Montreal in front of the Ottawa Roughriders.
What you like about this down here is they've got 2 plays from the 3-yard line. They try one, they're stopped on the inside. Normally the defense is thinking now they're going to come back again. If they do run inside, they came with the outside pitch. They got the people out in front of it. They score. That's the way to do the thing.
Well, they got a good job also from Rob Smith, who came around the corner with Alan Reed and blocked to the inside, sealed it off perfect where that inside pursuit couldn't get him. And Chuck McMahon come out. He did the rest of it.
Well, Al Bruno and several members of his Hamilton Tiger Cat coaching staff are in attendance at Olympic Stadium this afternoon, taking in the ball game, and we'll be talking with Al later on our telecast and getting his reaction. Of course, Ken Hobart is watching back at CFL control, and I think they will agree this is a different Montreal team than the one they faced earlier in the year. They're doing more things offensively. Gray on this kickoff return. They swarm all over him at the 30-yard line.
You know, you talk about Al Bruno, you know, everybody wants to know who he'd like to play in the final. He doesn't really care. He just wants them to beat each other up today. That's all he cares about.
Boy, Al Bruno's done a great job this year. I had an opportunity to interview him on my CFGM show this past week in Toronto, and he's the most matter-of-fact guy. And as you say, he doesn't care who he plays. All he knows is that he's got that Hamilton Tiger Cat team looking like the Tiger Cats of old, and they're pretty tough.
By the way, Leo, when do Lancaster and I get our fees for appearing on your CFGM show?
Now, we're going to work on that with the management, Dan. I know that you don't go anyplace for nothing.
Pointer got a handout and tried to haul down J.C. Watts. He stopped him at the 37-yard line, but that is a gain of 7 yards.
That was a great effort by J.C. Watts. He got outside and turned it into a big game for him.
3:07 is the time remaining in this first half. snow from the playing surface, but a lot of moisture still remains in that artificial carpet. Mark Berus takes that pass from J.C. Watts and will be very close to the first down at the 40-yard line.
Well, you see, J.C. Watts is starting to do the same thing that Montreal has had success with. Swing that ball out to those backs. It's always effective on any day because you get a one-on-one situation most of the time with a linebacker, but on a wet field, the offensive guy knows where he's going, and there's certainly an advantage today to that.
Yeah, he actually made more out of that play than I thought he was going to because he was able to use his quickness to get back inside, and he didn't slip, and it's going to be close enough now to where Joe Moss has to make a decision.
Take too long in making up their minds as to what they're going to do because that time clock is running.
For some reason, they reset it. It was down to 13 seconds, now it's back to 20.
Well, it's important that Ottawa gets in there and gets themselves established because they've already had one blocked.
He's got a real good chance one-on-one with him knowing where he's going and the defender having to really stalk him.
2:10, the time remaining, the clock running here at Olympic Stadium in the first half of this Eastern Conference semifinal. Second down play for Montreal. They swing it out to Alan Reid, and the throw was just a little too far ahead for Reid to grab, and Montreal is now forced into a punting situation.
Couldn't have been in a better defense. That three receivers over here. Ottawa just set in a zone, forced him to throw it outside. Joe threw a bad pass. I think even if he caught the football, it'd have been very limited yardage. They'd have still had the punt.
Tag has punted just twice this afternoon. And the Montreal Concordes aren't disappointed in that at all. There were times the punter has to go into the game. Successor having moving the ball, obviously. Stu Fraser on the attempted return, stopped at the 33-yard line by Mark Hopkins. That kick traveled just 32 yards.
Mark Hopkins has really done a job as far as the special teams is concerned. It should be pointed out, he's a York University graduate. When he came over here, he played defensive end, he played linebacker, he played any position Joe Gallant wanted him to play. But he's just as instrumental in their success now as a special teams guy, and he can back up a lot of positions. So a guy like that's important on a football team.
Most clubs have individual awards for people who stand out on those special teams. J.C. Watts trying to get out of bounds, and he was forced out on the far side of the field by Paul Gray.
Well, he did a wise thing, just holding on to the football because looking downfield, he had nobody open, and he took a long look at it before he made the decision to hang on to it. Good job in the defensive secondary by that Montreal club.
You can go deep occasionally on a field like this, especially with that real wide speed, but I think as Joe Barnes is doing, keep it short, swing to the backs, and throw the short passes, and you can sustain the football a lot easier and use your running attack on a day like today.
Second and six. George Smith gets some help. believe Ottawa finally came up with that ball, but J.C. Watts was dropped. George Smith made the initial contact, and then two other Montreal linemen, including Doug Scott, hit the Ottawa quarterback, and the Rough Riders were fortunate to come up with that ball way back at their own 10-yard line.
Boy, this is going to be interesting because it changes hands here about 14 times. I think it comes out of one guy's hands, out of another, comes out of the pile, down the field. A couple more guys get at it. I don't even want to name who they are, but finally Ottawa has the good luck, I should say, of probably recovering that ball, but they're kicking from their end zone, and on a day like this, it looks like Montreal might be coming after it.
The number of players that touch that football, Leo, you wouldn't have time to identify them all. Good kick by Clark out of the end zone. Patterson has to go back to his own 47-yard line. And he is stopped at the 53. There's also a penalty flag on the play.
Boy, Don, as you pointed out, an excellent kick by Clark, and he's kept him in more ball games this year. He's got a 47-yard average leading the league. But when you can kick the ball on a wet field, slippery field, out of your end zone with that kind of authority on it, you're doing a job.
And there is a penalty against Montreal.
Holding Montreal number 72. Down.
Well, the other thing, Don, it always impresses me about kickers. When you're backed up in your own end and kicking out of that end zone, that's when you have to hit the good one. Not when you're a midfielder kicking into the end zone. When you have to have it. Ken Clark delivered one right when the time was there.
A 52-yard kick, and with the holding call against Lamont Jeffers, the Montreal Concordes, who had anticipated excellent field position for this offensive series with just 1 minute remaining, are backed up into their own zone. Deep throw for Chris Haynes. He makes the catch at the 35. There's also a penalty flag.
Well, this is going to be interesting because I think they both had it equal rights on that football coming out, being up in the air like it was. But we're going to see what the official calls it. Yeah, he did call it on the Ottawa Rough Riders. But actually, I thought they both had an opportunity to go after that ball.
Ottawa number 35.
Kevin Gray was the man who was
first
pushing
down.
Chris
Go
Haynes.
Clock.
He's done a good job of coming back to that football on a number of Joe Barnes throws today.
I think we see it here. Both these guys are going to be doing a little pushing.
A guy like Haynes had his eyes on the ball looking back. Kevin Gray was looking at the receiver, and then Haynes tried to come back, and that's going to force Gray to run into him. I think it was a good call. It doesn't matter. He caught the ball anyway, but that's a good receiver to come back. He's got to find that football. Same as the defender. He just didn't do it.
Has now made five catches for 90 yards. 53 seconds remaining in the half. First down at the 35-yard line.
Look at that. He's coming right back to the swing out of the backfield. He's got a good thing going for him, Don.
Tony John takes it to the 25-yard line. He was forced out of bounds by Chris Siglett.
Well, I'll tell you, Joe saw that blitz coming up inside. They blitz those linebackers, and that forces again Chris Siglett to come all the way to the safety position and cover Reed, and he can't do it.
47 seconds remaining in the half.
You know, I've been critical of Joe Barnes throughout the year because although he's amassed a lot of statistics, he certainly hasn't got his teams in the end zone enough times. But Joe is a wily guy, and when he gets something going, he's smart enough to stick with it. He's got that swing pass going right now.
Well, already Barnes is throwing for more yardage in this first half, 202 yards, completing 16 of 22. Concord were picking up in an entire game when they were in that slump late September, early October.
Well, I think you said it a little earlier, they're doing a few more things offensively, and when you're doing things offensively, more things can happen for you, and today they are.
The measurement reveals that at second and inches, Barnes will keep. He'll just get it if, in fact, he does have a first down. Ottawa defensively stacked things up pretty good in the middle. Barnes does have a first down. I think one of the key moves for Gary Dirchick was moving Tony Johns into a starting position as a running back. That freed up an import to play elsewhere.
Well, he's done a good job. Johns has done a good job for him.
Penalty flag as Johns grabs the throw to the 20-yard line. It will probably be holding against Montreal.
I believe Blake Neal grabbed Greg Marshall
and brought him down, and that's going to, you can't do that in front of the official and expect to get away with it.
Buzz Ferrier marches off the yardage against Montreal.
Holding. Montreal number 60. First down repeated.
Blake Hill indeed, the guilty party. Sometimes that's the only way you can stop Greg Marshall from getting into that backfield.
Well, he's a great pass rusher, and you're going to hold him every now and then. There's no doubt about it. You don't want the quarterback getting hit.
First and 20 from the 35-yard line. Barnes is going to be chased by Jeff Roberts, and caught.
Boy, that's just big speed. That's all it is big speed. And again, he came to the inside, and Joe got the position on him to get to the outside, but he flattened right down the line of scrimmage and used speed to catch him. You see Joe now go outside of him. Now, look at Roberts. He's on the inside, but look at him come. And he gets a hold of on the outside, and Joe didn't have a chance to do what most good quarterbacks should do, and that's waste that football, not take that big loss.
Well, he got flushed out of there from somebody inside, and then Roberts, as you say, later, just used that speed to go after him. It's second down in about 3 miles.
Don, while we're talking about the outstanding player defensively of the game, he's going to have to probably receive some consideration from us.
Well, he does have that great speed, and that has certainly taken Montreal out of field goal range, although Tony Johns might put them right back in it as he rambles to the 35-yard line with just 7 seconds remaining in this first half.
Well, I think it's worth a chance. 7 seconds last play, you got a chance to kick it through there. It's going to be about a 42, 43 yarder, but I think you got to try it.
Boy, this would be a sensational place for a fake field goal pass. Nobody in the world would be expecting it right here. 7 seconds left.
The first field goal attempt by Roy Kurtz was from 42 yards out, and it fell short. This will be from 43.
Ottawa called time.
The Ottawa Rough Riders have called the timeout. We mentioned that Roy Kurtz has not been handling the kickoff chores for Montreal because of the leg problem. And Gary Dirchuk was telling us yesterday that this is something that Kurtz has been forced to live with since training camp. He and Bernie Ruoff, prior to going to training camp, Ruoff, the Hamilton Tiger Cat place kicker, were getting ready for training camp when Kurtz injured his leg. And throughout the season, he has been kicking with that problem.
They've had time right now, Ron, to think about it a little bit, and I think you're going to see that the Ottawa defense are going to be a little bit cautious about playing that that fake field goal pass. Jerry Dottilio is in there holding, and Jerry has been known from time to time to do things like that.
Well, we'll take a look. I think they were lined up in a prevent, like, you know, they're going to keep those defensive backs back there. Make them kick it at the field goal. Don't let them take the opportunity to score the touchdown, but get those guys inside to go in there hard with those hands up, because when you have a bad leg, you don't always get the height you need on it, and they block it.
That's right.
The kick by Kurt. It's wide. And Ricky Barton gets it out of the end zone and returns it to the 15-yard line, and that will be the final play of the first half here in this Eastern Conference semifinal at Olympic Stadium, with the Montreal Concordes heading to the dressing room leading by 3. Now, stay tuned for our halftime show.
Doing a great job, and it just confidence all over the group playing good ball.
Okay, Al, good luck to you.
Thanks a lot.
Dean Dorsey kicked off to open the second half. Vince Faison is going to bring it back to only about his 20-yard line. And Montreal have first 10, somewhere around the 25. It's hard to see those numbers down there, Don.
Yes, indeed. That snowfall earlier today, and then the heavy equipment moving out onto the playing field to remove that slush, has obliterated some of the yardage markings here at Olympic Stadium. Ball between the 25 and the 30-yard line. Let's make it the 27 and a half for this first down play. Joe Barnes sends three receivers out to the right, then gives the ball straight ahead to Tony Johns, who crosses the 30 to the 32. A pickup of about 4. Right now, let's go down and join Steve Armitage on the sideline.
Don, I talked to Chris Hayes just before he went into the ball game. He is wearing a special pair of gloves. They are scuba gloves. I asked him if he had any stick them on him. He said, no, they're sticky enough as it is, and they're doing wonders for him because he came up with a couple of big catches in the first half of the Concord.
Well,
some football players a couple of years ago began experimenting with those scuba divers' gloves. And this is Jeff Patterson, who is not wearing gloves of any kind, but he hangs on to the football for a first down. But there's a penalty flag on the play. That's the first time this afternoon they have gone to Patterson, and the penalty is being assessed against Ottawa. Play call takes it to the 52-yard line. Let's listen.
Major foul, unnecessary roughness. Ottawa 79.
Well, apparently we are having some technical problems in hearing referee Ross Perrier explain the penalty, but it was a rough play call. It appeared to be roughing the passer against the Ottawa Rough Riders, and it's a first down, Montreal at the 52 of Ottawa. Decides to run it himself, and he got to the 50-yard line for a gain of just 2 yards. And again, the man in pursuit was Jeff Roberts.
And also the man with Jeff Roberts is Lloyd Lewis. So those two have been all over the field today, and especially after Joe Barnes.
And Joe Barnes, you know, for an experienced quarterback, he takes more losses back there than anybody I've ever seen. That time he just about made it to the line of scrimmage a little bit past there, but I don't know if it's because he's lost some of his mobility or just exactly what it is, but it seems to me he gets caught an awful lot.
Second and eight. Barnes to Tony Johns, and Johns will be stopped 3 yards short of the first down by middle linebacker Al Washington.
As Barnes comes off this field, he's holding his hand. It looks to me like he hurt a shoulder or a hand. We'll see the next time he comes on the field what effect this has on him.
Barnes was limping noticeably at practice on Thursday. He has been bothered for the past couple of weeks by an ankle injury, but apparently they are able to tape it to permit Barnes to play.
Well, one thing that nobody ever said about Barnes, and that was that he wasn't tough. He will play hurt or do what he has to do.
Mike McTagg's third down kick bounces to Catterbone. He had a little trouble fielding it and wisely decided simply to drop on that ball rather than risk fumbling it and turning it over to the Montreal Concordes. It will be first and 10 Ottawa when we return. Joe Moss, the head coach of the Ottawa Rough Riders, somewhat more subdued this afternoon. I suppose that would be the reaction of most coaches if they were nicked for $2,000, as Joe Moss was.
Boy, that'll smart a little bit.
The pitch to Tim McCray, and he got up to the 22-yard line. Pick up a three, stopped by middle linebacker Paul Gray. Yes, next Sunday afternoon, it will be the Western Final from the Dome in Vancouver as the British Columbia Lions entertain either the Winnipeg Blue Bombers or the Edmonton Eskimos. Those two teams meet later this afternoon in the Western semifinal in Winnipeg. Clark gets to the outside, throws incomplete. It is intercepted by Harry Skipper.
Listen, I think we're going to get a pass interference call, and I don't believe it if we do.
Penalty flag on that throw intended for Baruch.
Soldier.
It goes against Bill Jones.
Believe it, Ron.
I see it.
That's a pass interference. Montreal number 18.
Somewhere else on the field.
Well, I hope so, but I didn't like it that spot.
J.C. Watts faked the throw, then pulled it down, and will be very close to another Ottawa first down. Again, let's bring in Steve Armitage.
Don, I talked to Joe Barnes just a few moments ago. He was shaken up on that last play, but the trainer says there is nothing wrong with him, and Joe says, I'm going back in. This is too important a game to sit on the bench.
Well, as Leo said, you have to admire the toughness of this veteran quarterback of the Montreal Concordes. He's been hobbling all week with that ankle problem. He has taken some shots since joining Montreal from the Calgary Stampeders.
In a lot of ways, he really hasn't been Joe Barnes this year. It's been a tough year on him, but he's a good guy, and he'll come back.
First down, Ottawa. J.C. Watt dropping straight back, still looking. Finally throws deep. This one is intercepted by Phil Jones. And there is also a penalty flag, a late flag, back at the line of scrimmage. An altercation taking place after the interception.
Don, that was just an unbelievable throw. I can't believe he threw the football, but this hit, as you see, there's no one near the ball. It has to be a great interception. There's no Ottawa Rough Riders there, but then Steve Rocky really drilled Jim Reed, and that's what this penalty's for.
Well, look at Joe Moss. Look at his reaction on the sidelines. I think that he's got to be talking to his quarterback, and he
Ottawa
is.
Ottawa 99 after the interception.
I know what he's telling him. You should have never thrown that ball, J.C. There was nobody in that area, nobody open.
Well, Steve Rocky, as you said, Ron, was the man charged with unnecessary roughness following that Phil Jones interception. Montreal has the ball, but they are back at their own 15-yard line. Alan Reed ran into one of his own men. The ball pops loose, and Ottawa is indicating that they have recovered. Ottawa defensive players continue to claim that it is their ball, but the officials rule otherwise. It will be second and 10. The score, 9:43, the time remaining in the third quarter. Montreal leading in this Eastern semifinal. The winner moving on to the Eastern Championship next week at Iverwind Stadium against the Ticats. The pass is intercepted. Dixon makes the interception over on the far side of the field. There's also a penalty flag on the play. A penalty against Montreal. So the Ottawa Rough Riders take over deep in Montreal territory at the 20-yard line.
And there's a reaction from another coach, Gary Dirchik, on the sidelines right there. That's frustrating because actually Joe just peeled off on that bootleg and overthrew the receiver right into the hands of the defender right there. And it was just at that part of the field, it's a sad thing to happen. I was watching Joe Moss on the other side of the field on that last call. I'll tell you one thing, one more close call and Joe might say, what the hell, I'm going to blow another 2,000.
First and 10 from the 20-yard line. Oh. A poorly thrown ball by J.C. Watts as he intended that pass for Stu Fraser, but it bounced a good 5 yards in front of him.
I'll cover for J.C. here. He took a pretty good hit from Doug Scott just as he starts to release the football. Stu Fraser was open and around the 5-yard line, but Doug Scott hit him pretty good, and the ball, as you say, was at least 5 yards short.
How'd you like to come on the sidelines and face that guy after throwing a couple of short passes?
I'd go over there then. Sorry, coach. And I'd walk a long way away from him, too.
Bob Shaw grabbed you a couple times out in Saskatchewan.
Watts throwing over the middle, incomplete. He was intending that pass for Tim McCray, and middle linebacker Paul Gray had him all wrapped up there.
Well, he's just like a safety valve here, Leo. Ball's thrown, takes a good hit from Paul Gray. Paul Gray, he leads that team with something like 88 solo tackles this year, so you know he'll hit you.
Well, when you get down to that part of the field, as good a runner as J.C. Watts is, and as much as he can threaten the line of scrimmage with his run, he ought to roll out and take the opportunity to run or pass instead of getting back there and with indecision on his throws.
Dean Dorsey's field goal attempt ties the game at 13. So with 8:27 remaining in this third quarter, we've got a tie ball game in this Eastern Conference semifinal. Ottawa 13, Montreal 13. Yes, indeed, CBC Television will be bringing you all the excitement of Grey Cup week. beginning with the Shenley Awards, the Grey Cup Parade, and all the associated activities, the pregame show, and the game itself. The pass is completed over the middle to Mike McTagg for a gain of 9. He was wrapped up by middle linebacker Al Washington. Both McTagg and Araki, the two Montreal slot backs, were named to the Eastern Conference All-Star team.
Got about a yard here to go, so we're going to see whether they come with the halfback lead or whether Joe Byrnes is going to get it himself. What do you think, Ron?
We're going to run the back a little more in a yard, a little over a yard. I think they'll run the halfback.
They give to Tony Johns. He's got the first down as he got across the 45-yard line. Tom Towns brought down Johns, but not before he had picked up that first down. 7:33 is the time left in the third quarter with the score tied at 13.
We're going to run. Let's just watch Tom Towns. He fights through, gets his hands on him. John tried to cut back into the middle. He didn't really want too much. He got what he wanted, just the first down. That's enough.
The pitch to Alan Reed. Reed cutting back inside. And a good defensive effort there by middle linebacker Al Washington coming across to restrict the game to 3 yards.
You look at the score, 13-all, and I think it's been that kind of game. I don't think either team has definitely showed that they're in control of it yet. It seems to be seesawing back and forth, and who can put it in the end zone.
They bring it out to Tony Johns coming out of the backfield, but he is stopped a good 4 yards short of a first down by Ralph Dixon.
Well, that's a great one-on-one tackle by Dixon, because if he misses that tackle, he's going to make the first and 10, and they're going to be able to keep control of that football.
This is the only thing that you got here in terms of defense, is to drop those linebackers back. When he swings out to the outside, just come up and close the distance. And as you say, Ron, stay on balance, measure the guy, don't give yourself up, and make the tackle. Make sure you get that tackle. That's exactly what Dixon did that time.
McTagg stands at his own 37 for this third down kick. Fraser takes it at his 27-yard line and returns it to the 34, where he is stopped by Vince Faison. That kick by McTagg traveled just 31 yards. Fraser returned it 7 yards.
I think this is going to be a very, very telltale sequence of downs right here, because on the last two sequence of downs, J.C. Watts looked like he was showing the effects of being a little bit tight after throwing that interception. And I think right now he's got to get it back on track or he's going to be in trouble.
Got to make some first down. They'll put a drive together. If he does that, they'll get that offense in track.
Hudson is now in the game at that spot back position in place of Stu Fraser. The ball fumbled by McCray. Montreal claims they got it. They do.
One thing you didn't want to happen. You need to get something going offensively. You can't do it without the ball. They caught Montreal in a blitz, and it makes it very difficult to run. And you saw Phil Jones right up on the line of scrimmage. You see them all up there, and the ball's handed off. Now, as he comes in, you'll see number 6 up there on the line of scrimmage. That means they were blitzing, and the ball comes loose, and Montreal has a chance to take control if they can move it in.
Well, you know, I said it was a telltale sequence of downs. If Montreal can take it in right here, the whole momentum will shift over to Montreal's side. They got the veteran quarterback.
Gray, a product of Western Kentucky, coming up with that ball. They tried to swing it out again to Tony Johns, and that ball was knocked down at the line of scrimmage by Greg Marshall.
Well, that's what they've had success on, just swing that ball out there to the back, let him run. But this time Greg Marshall did what he should do. If he can't make the sack, get the hands up, and he did, and deflected the football.
Boy, he was open, though. If he would have got the ball to him, I think he would have come pretty close to making the first down. And Joe's going to take that, as we've said before, just as long as they'll give it to him and get the deep drop by those linebackers, he'll keep dishing it off to those backs.
Second and 10 from the 36. Barnes throwing down the sidelines. It was intended for Patterson, and he, I think, was anticipating that shot from Chris Ziegler, as Ziegler from his free safety spot came over and really belted Patterson as he initially started to reach out for the football and then realized it was a good 3 or 4 yards ahead of him.
Ron, how many times this afternoon has Joe Barnes had opportunities with field position to get points and come out with, at the most points, a field goal. And this time, they maybe get a field goal out of this, but they're going to have to kick it like the devil to get one. But he's got to be able to get points when he gets that kind of a break.
Both quarterbacks need to do that. On that play, they just rolled that corner up, and Joe tried to dump it into that dead spot. And when you do, you're running a collision course with Siegler, and that was a pretty good collision.
As Patterson comes to the bench, he is feeling the effects of that hit. The field goal attempt by Kurt. It's good. Injured leg and all, Roy Kurt comes through to put the Montreal Concordes in front once again with 4:45 remaining in the third quarter. Position, and they are asking Montreal to kick off after that field goal by Kurt, and Mike McTagg is the man who performs the kickoff chore, but Kevin Gray on the return is caught by Paul Gray at the 30-yard line, so they lost 5 yards.
You know, most kickoff teams and coaches will freeze when that guy catches the football, get in behind that wedge and accelerate straight upfield. And as soon as you hesitate, you're in trouble. And he did and tried to give it and lost yardage. And as you say, they lost 5 yards.
Ron, especially when you're going to get Mike McTagg kicking off and it's going to be a short kickoff, why try to make a big run out of it when you're going to get the ball on the 30-yard line on the kickoff? Take it right straight upfield and get as much as you can.
Montreal leading by three as J.C. Watts on first down dropped back, just got it away. But he was hit from behind as he released by Steve Rocky. For an injury report, let's go to Steve Armitage.
Don, you're looking at the injured player Patterson on the Montreal bench. He simply had his bell rung on that play. You anticipated that he saw the defender coming. He did indeed. He got hit, and they gave him some smelling salts, and they're not taking any chances. He's going to sit out a couple of plays.
He looks like he should be exorcist.
He took quite a blow from Sigler over on those sidelines, and he is relaxing at that Montreal bench. J.C. Watts isn't relaxing. He's running with the ball for big yardage. He picks up the first down, a gain of 16 to the 46. Stopped finally by Vince Faison.
Ron, this is a game where it's all or nothing at all. There's no tomorrow in these playoff games, and this is what this kid does best. Run with the football, get to the outside. If there's nobody open, take the chance and run. There's nothing to save himself for. There's no senior prom, nothing else. That's the thing he should do down there on the 20-yard line when he gets in there close. Get to the outside and use that ability that he's got.
First and 10, Ottawa from the 46. 3:20 is the time left to play in the third quarter. Montreal leads by three. Quarterback draw. And J.C. Watts has a gain of maybe 8 yards before being stopped by Brett Williams.
I think he heard you, Leo. They've been concentrating so much on keeping him inside the pocket with the outside rush. He took advantage of it, let him come from the outside, just step back and follow those big linemen upfield. There's Tim McCray. See what he's going to do. He's just looking for somebody. You lead him and I'll follow you. And that's about what he did. Picks up seven.
Has carried seven times for 66 yards. He's getting almost a first down every time he runs with the football. This time he throws, and it's incomplete, intended for spotback Mike Hudson, and it was almost intercepted on the deflection by Harry Skipper.
What you have hands for as a receiver, reach up and catch it in those hands and try to cradle it in with the arms, and it bounced off the shoulder pad. Boy, that was a big, big miss, because that would have given them the first down that they needed to keep the drive alive.
Now, I'm not making any excuses for Mike Hudson, but he hasn't been in there. He's been injured a little bit. He's been on the sidelines. It's an extremely cold day. His hands are probably cold, but you got to catch that football.
Ken Clark is punting to Phil Jones and Harry Skipper. He already has had one block this afternoon. Phil Jones takes that third down punt on the run back to the 31-yard line. That kick traveled just 37 yards. The best kick of the afternoon by Ken Clark under extreme pressure late in the first half when he booted one 52 yards out of his end zone. Joe Moss talking with his offensive unit, particularly the receivers, Catterbone and Hudson, along with the wide men, Thad Jemison and Mark Berus. Drop play, and Johns was hit, fumbled the football, but the whistle had gone.
Once again, Jeff Roberts come down from the defensive end on the draw and made the good hit, limited that gain to only about a yard. And the defense is going to have to do it. They're going to have to get the field position because Otto hasn't shown they can consistently move that football on offense yet.
Well, I'll tell you one thing. That Jeff Roberts, as you said, Ron, was in there. He not only made the tackle, but Tony Johns is having a hard time getting up. And he has been all over the field this afternoon. He's rushed the passer. He's caught the quarterback on rollouts. He's been up in his face and now on a running play. And there he's in there and making a real hit on Tony Johns. So this guy has had a great day.
While we have an opportunity, we would like to remind all BC football fans once again that next Sunday's Western Final takes place under the dome at the stadium at BC Place, involving the Lions and either Winnipeg or Edmonton. And Josh Keller, the BC Public Relations Director, informs that about 7,500 tickets are still available throughout the lower mainland at all the usual ticket outlets.
Well, you see the draw coming. John steps into the hole. Roberts gets hold of him. Get a little tangled up, and down he goes.
And Chuck McMahon has gone into the ball game to replace Tony Johns, and that Western Final, BC and either Winnipeg or Edmonton, will be seen on CBC television.
For Rocky, wide open. First down to the 46-yard line. And there's another injured Montreal player. And there's also a penalty flag in the Montreal backfield.
I'll tell you what Joe Barnes did on this play here. He's been hitting, as you see Chris Haynes down there, look like he's holding his knee, and we'll get a referee's call right here.
Major foul, roughing the passer, Ottawa number 79. First down.
That's a compound one right there. But what Joe Barnes did so good on this is he's been dropping back and hitting his swing back as he swung out of the backfield. He looks to the swing back, and Araki goes right down and crosses in the middle, and he hits Araki right on the numbers. Good job.
And you saw just coming into the picture, Jeff Roberts decking Joe Barnes after he had thrown the football to Araki.
You know, Don, you never want to take a player's aggressiveness away from him, but that's two roughing penalties today against Jeff Roberts, and they usually come at the time when you can least afford it, and right now happens to be one of those times with a 16-13 lead for Montreal. You see, get the hand up by Marshall, but bang, the ball has gone to Araki into the hole. Great throw. He's been thrown to the back, as you say, Leo, and that opened that up for him. But boy, you hate to see 15-yard roughing penalties tacked on.
And Chris Haynes, I didn't see what happened to Chris Haynes, number 19, but he is in a lot of pain down there with a, looks like a knee injury or a leg injury of some kind. They're going to have to help him off the field, but didn't see what happened to him, but he got a real crack. Now let's go to Steve Armitage on the sidelines. I think he can tell us about what's happened.
Leo, I can tell you what's the problem with Chris Haynes. He is holding his left knee. It's definitely a knee injury. The injury to Johns was simply an ankle sprain. He had some extra tape put on it, and he'll go back into the ballgame. But with Haynes, it is definitely his left knee.
That means that Jerry DiTillio, backup quarterback, goes into the ballgame as a wide receiver. And Haynes has been a key man in that Montreal passing attack this afternoon. Tony Johns, as Steve said, not seriously hurt. He is back on the field and in the lineup, but Chris Haynes is still down, and they have not yet removed him from the playing field.
I'm not sure that Chris Haynes just didn't try to break to the outside and lose his footing and either get hung up in that turf or not, because he really didn't get hit.
And I feel like this, when you make a plant, you can very well have that knee go out of place. And he's up on his feet right now, though, and it looks like he's bending the knee. And hard to tell, though, just exactly what's going to happen after he tries to run on it. But Jerry DiTillio is in there, Don, at the wide receiver spot. The first thing that I think of, Ron, when the wide receiver happens to be a quarterback, is what about that hitch and pitch? Get it out there to him, let him throw it.
He won a Shenley Award as the Outstanding Canadian a few years back. Stanley Awards, part of this week, this year's Grey Cup festivities. And, of course, you'll see it all on CBC television.
They tried a little shovel pass, Don. Just sprint Barnes out to the right and bring Alan Reed underneath it, or Tony Johns, and then just come dump it over his head and let him run. And Michelle Bourgeau was there. They had the pressure on Barnes. They had everything covered. And they were very fortunate it's not intercepted.
Some good personal statistics for Joe Barnes this afternoon, completing 21 of 31. And he has also thrown a couple that have been dropped.
I'll tell you, Ma Barnes may have raised some fat kids, but she never raised any fools. Those little swing passes will really fatten your statistics.
Sideline pattern. Shop the lane will be close to a first down at the 20-yard line. Chris Ames has the ice bag on his injured knee and is grimacing in pain at that Montreal bench. The Concordes have been forced to substitute at both wide receiver positions with Patterson and Haynes going out. Shop Delane and DeTilio are in.
I've always been impressed by Shop Delane. It's nice to see him get a chance to play, and this is a big game. We'll see what he can do, because this is the time you have to come up big.
13 seconds remaining in the third quarter. First down, Barnes throws it up there, and there was a mix-up involving McTagg and Shop Delane. Neither went into the end zone. If, in fact, that's where they were supposed to go, Barnes threw it there anyway.
That's the one thing you have to worry about when you have the new receivers in there. Joe Barnes, in his practice procedures throughout the week, is spending most of his time with his regular receivers. I mean, as you know, Ron, better than anybody else, it takes a lot of time and a lot of timing to work with your receivers. When you got two brand-new guys in there, that can happen.
There was a mix-up, and Barnes did the smart thing. He threw it away. He did a wise thing with the ball. He just grounded that one.
Second and 10 from the 20-yard line. Inside for a Rocky. Touchdown.
Well, when you want to blitz inside and a target like a Rocky gets into the middle, Chris Sigler just isn't big enough and strong enough to bring him down when he gets up ahead of steam. And that's a great read by Barnes and a Rocky.
Well, that's the one thing we said about Barnes before the ball game even begun, was that he is a veteran. He can take the rush. And again, the back swung out of the backfield to the right. He looked to the back, swinging down the backfield, and then just dealt it right down the middle to Araki coming across the middle. And we said before, Araki could break tackles with his strength in the open field, and he got in the end zone for the touchdown.
Araki initially pulled away from Chris Sigler, and he fought his way those final 3 yards for the major score. This game is taking its toll. There is another injured Concord.
You see Araki looking inside. Now, as soon as them linebackers disappear, he looks to the football, bounces off of it, gets hit once, twice, still scores. And that's what we said earlier in the game when we said he has to be involved in the offense. He's made two big catches in his stride.
Well, early in the year when Montreal did not throw to the wide receivers, team simply defended against Araki. They doubled up inside on Araki, and basically that took away the Montreal offense.
That's exactly what it did. When your wide receivers aren't involved in the game, you can concentrate inside. And once you get those wide receivers involved, it'll open up a lot of things inside for a guy like Araki, who likes it in there where it's tough.
Well, I know it's, as you see, Gary Dirchik, the new head coach of the Concord, there on the sidelines. He's looking around on the bench and seeing all these guys going down, and there's a guy up here sitting in the press box right now, and I know it's not a very charitable thing to be doing, but he's sitting down there, and he's hoping probably at this stage that Montreal wins, because they won't have too many left to play against his Tiger Cats next week.
You're talking, of course, about Al Bruno, the head coach of the Hamilton Tiger Cats, who is watching this game from the press box.
That's a good job right there. You see the play executed well by the quarterback and receiver. But what a lot of people don't notice is that linebacker blitzes inside and he's coming free. Tony John steps over there and knocks Tom Towns off balance, and that allowed Barnes to make the throw.
Guard Rob Smith was the injured player. Already Chris Haynes and Jeff Patterson are out of the ball game. As a matter of fact, Haynes is now being removed to the Montreal Concord dressing room. Smith is able to get up and run off to the Montreal bench, so he likely will be returning. His spot is being taken by Jerry Dopravolny for this point after by Roy Kurtz. He puts it through, and it's now a 23-13 ball game, a 10-point differential. The Montreal Concours leading, and that is also the end of the third quarter in the semifinal game at Olympic Stadium.
place of the injured Roy Kurtz. Kurtz is available, of course, for field goal and point after duties. McTaggan practiced this week, was not kicking it particularly deep. He hasn't hit one very deep either in the ball game so far. This is his best kick to the 15-yard line to Catterbone. They're trying to set up the wall to the left. Catterbone ran into one of his own men. And then Miles Darling came in to make sure he stayed down.
Well, you look at the clock. 15 minutes left in somebody's season this year. And in the third quarter, Montreal has definitely taken control. Ottawa's offense hasn't been able to get on track. And right now, J.C. Watts has got to get the club moving if Ottawa's going to survive.
First and 10, the ball is at the 25-yard line. Miles Darling playing that cornerback position on the left side. Sideline pattern intended for Jemison, incomplete. Even if he had made the catch, he was out of bounds.
Well, Joe Moss made the statement early in the week that J.C. Watts was having a good game, that they had a very good chance of winning, and if he was having a poor game, that he would be just as advised to be up in the stands selling popcorn. And J.C.'s got to get it on track here, and Joe's better turn around and get the popcorn on his back.
Well, J.C. Watts does not have very good statistics through three quarters, completing just 7 of 17 for less than 100 yards. He's forced to run the ball, and he is going to be stopped short of a first down by about 2 yards by Lamont Jeffers. His Montreal defensive unit is putting much more pressure on J.C. Watts than they did in the first two games of regular season play.
Well, we know for sure that last game when we were here, J.C. Watts had a field day rolling around, throwing to receivers and back. That's the day Mike Hudson caught 10 passes, I believe. But today it's a little different story. He's scrambling a lot back there. He's not having the success. He hasn't had the time to take and look around back there.
Somehow, J.C. Watts has been an option-type quarterback at the University of Oklahoma, and he's never really learned to take the rush as a drop-back passer. And we said that before the ball game, that Joe Barnes could take the rush and could spot those guys and get to those player guys and those quick guys when they're coming with the blitz. But J.C. somehow, when the rush gets up in his face, he kind of panics a little bit and always goes to the run, and that's been his history this afternoon.
Joe Moss and his Ottawa Rough Riders trailing by 10 with 13:58 remaining in the ball game. The winner will advance against the Hamilton Tiger Cats for the Eastern Championship next Sunday at Ivor Wynne Stadium in Hamilton. Alan Reed is back on this punt return unit. He takes that third down kick by Ken Clark and is stopped at the 47-yard line by Rick Sovieta. That's where Montreal will scrimmage first and 10 when we return. Well, in the third quarter, three starters were injured offensively for Montreal. Two of them are still out, Patterson and Haynes, but Rob Smith has returned at that offensive guard spot. Off to Tony Johns. Johns breaks one tackle, and Johns fights his way to the 45 of Ottawa, stopped by Kevin Gray.
Excellent track block. Rob Smith pulling from his right offensive guard position, blocked out on the defensive end. Right, made a great block, and then Johns cut right inside of him and turned a good gain. That's what Montreal wants right now. Eat the clock with the running game. Watch that clock tick away.
Nine carries for 51 yards for Tony Johns, first and 10, Montreal at the 46 of Ottawa. Barnes setting up the screen to Johns. Still on his feet. Excellent running by the rookie from Henderson State. Down to the 21, stopped by Lamont Meacham.
Excellent call by Barnes. Run the ball, come back with a safe play like a screen, big game.
Bruno, that's one thing that Joe Barnes can do about as well as anybody is pick out the weaknesses and go with them.
He's doing a great job. He finally found a Reiki in there. He's doing a great job. I tell you, he's really picking them apart, Leo.
Al Bruno, head coach of the Hamilton Tiger Cats. We made a comment earlier in the telecast. This is a different Montreal team offensively than the one you played earlier in the year. They're doing a few more things.
They sure are. They're spirited and they're enthusiastic. And look at it. They just keep going down the field.
said earlier in the third quarter, it didn't look like any team had taken control yet before the Montreal Concordes have definitely owned it since about the 8-minute mark in the third quarter. And right now, they are in control. And I don't really know if Ottawa can come back right now because the way they're going, they're going to put this in the end zone.
Michel Bourgeois is the injured Ottawa player, and when they spotted that ball, it was a Montreal first down. Gary Durchick, in only his third game as head coach of this Montreal football team, replacing Joe Gallap, who decided that he had to make a change and the coach should go, so he remained in the general manager's office and appointed Durchick to succeed him following that 30-7 loss here at Olympic Stadium on the 19th of October.
Well, Al Bruno, a lot of people say that Joe Byrnes can only come through with a couple real big games every year, but when he's hot, he's hot, and he looks like he's getting hot at the right time.
He's just picking him apart there, and he's just, you know what he can do. He's an experienced quarterback, and he's just moving down the field.
11:44 is the time remaining. Ron Engelson has replaced Michel Bourgeois at that defensive tackle position. First and 10, Montreal over the middle. Araki to the goal line. He is stopped at the one. That should be a first down, though.
You know what to do, Ron? They really got concerned early in the ball game when they swung the backs out of the backfield, and the linebackers that are dropping back in there in the middle to take care of that crossing pattern are concerned with those backs swinging out of the backfield and hesitating a little bit, and Araki is getting in there in the middle and catching the ball.
Yeah, that time they ran Chris Ziegler and Tom Towns out on the back, and that opened it wide open for Araki. And Barnes, well, as Al said, he's experienced and he knows what he's doing, and he's got it figured out.
Leading the Ottawa Rough Riders. Remember, in the two regular season games,
The Ottawa Rough Riders dominated, winning 23-7 and 37. So in those two games, they outscored Montreal 53-14. J.C. Watt throws the pass over the middle for a gain of just 3 yards. Jim McRae took the pass.
I was interested to watch the Montreal defense. Now, Ottawa has to have a big play, and they have to have it now. They're down too far. I was anxious to see what Montreal's defense would do. They were 25 yards deep. They're not going to give them that big play right now, and that's what they have to be concerned with. If Ottawa scores, make them use time off the clock, and that's everything in Montreal's favor now. They're just careful on defense.
Get the big play out of that front four.
They need a second down conversion right now. J.C. Watt tries to deliver. He overthrows Mike Catterbone. And that forces Ottawa to kick.
You can't run that pattern if they tried right there against that particular defense at Montreal. And they just sit in the zone. They can run around and do all they want. Their defensive backs are just going to sit there and wait on the football.
And that number six right there, he doesn't look like he has the confidence that he has to have at this stage of the football game. He's erratic in his passing, and he's a little bit indeterminate about what he's going to do with his football team. He's got to get them together because time is running out.
Alan Reed is back with Phil Jones on this punt return unit. The ball bounces to Jones. And very quickly, Thad Jamison got down to make the tackle at the 34-yard line. A 42-yard kick that time by Ken Clark. A run back at 5 by Jones. Closer to the big game here at Olympic Stadium on the 24th of November. We've still got a lot of football action coming your way. We'll be in Vancouver next Sunday for that Western final involving the British Columbia Lions and either Winnipeg or Edmonton. They're looking for a full house under the dome at the stadium at BC Place. Still about 7,500 tickets available, but that could be a tremendous ball game, that battle for the Western Championship.
Well, you know, any football game, I like all football games. The Western Final over the years has been just an outstanding game, and what a better place to play it than in Vancouver.
One of the more memorable Western Finals I can recall took place at Clark Stadium in Edmonton. Do you remember the fog rolling in that year?
Oh, yeah, I remember. That was really unbelievable. We only had it for about 2 minutes, but you couldn't see anything.
Our producer kept running replays, and we didn't see it the first time. Takes the pass up to the 45-yard line, and Ralph Dixon forces him out of bounds. Another Montreal first down.
You know what's funny right now is that Al Bruno made the point. We've made the point that Barnes is just moving up and down the field. And right here, you know, he's got a big lead. You think he would run the football, play it safe, punt the football, let the defense play? His confidence is such today that he just feels, I'll just take him down and score again if they're not careful.
I think, Ron, we ought to point out, though, that he's very confident in the type of passes that he's throwing. Swing passes and short passes. And look at that stat there. Wouldn't that shock you a little bit before this ball game to think it could turn out that way?
Alan Reed fumbles the football. He got it. I believe Reed recovered himself. It was pulled out of his hands by Michelle Bourgeois. But now let's go to Steve Armitage for another injury report.
Don, the reason you haven't seen number 26, Harry Skipper, on the punt return team for the Montreal Concordes is very simple. He took a knock on the knee. It's a bruise. The coaching staff of the Concordes simply aren't taking any chances.
They've had enough people go down this afternoon who have been unable to return, and as you said, Steve, wisely, they are not taking any more chances. Joe Barnes has also been shaken up this afternoon, and he was hurt coming into the ball game. So if, in fact, Montreal advances to the Eastern Final next Sunday against Hamilton, you're going to be a bruised and battered football team.
That's always the danger of playing in the semifinal game, and that's why a lot of teams, you know, want to finish first to kick, because it's always a bruising affair, regardless of whether you win or lose. It's just that the losers have all year to heal, and you got to be ready to go in 7 days. But I don't know. I just say there's something about it. Those bruises will heal fast when you got a shot of going to the Grey Cup, too.
Montreal Concordes would dearly love to play in a Grey Cup right here in their home ballpark in 2 weeks' time. And if Joe Barnes continues against Hamilton as he has this afternoon in this semifinal game against Ottawa. They've got a chance.
Well, he was over on the sidelines talking to Coach Durchick, and I'm sure that Durchick told him to use your running attack now and try, as Ron said before, to take as much time off this clock as possible.
Now Washington was the injured player. Ireland replaced him at that middle linebacking position. Tony Johns, the ball carrier.
That was exactly the same play there that they broke loose before on a long game by Johns going the other way. Or I guess it was going the same way, but that time the Ottawa football team had it pretty well solved.
Al Washington has been an outstanding performer for Ottawa all through the year, and when you lose your middle linebacker, you know, that hurts a little bit, but Ireland come in, made the tackle, and hopefully Washington will be ready to go. They got to try to block this punt somehow right now.
7:50 is the time remaining. They were going after it. Catterbone was coming from the outside. On the dead run, Stu Fraser takes that third down punt and bounces high in the air and gets to the 42-yard line, and that's where Ottawa will scrimmage first and 10. 7:34 is the time left to play in the ball game. 30-13, Montreal leads Ottawa. First and 10, Ottawa. They are at the 42-yard line.
Bootleg pattern again when J.C. wants to fake to McCray and then roll out. And we're going to see him take the hit. Pretty good hit to stand him up and one to finish him off. And the way these teams are going right now, just looking down on the field, you know, the enthusiasm is all of the guys with the red jerseys.
Montreal can taste it. And, you know, as we've said so often in the past, they had such a great season to start out with. And they ended up in the middle of the season slowing down. Now they're coming strong again.
And with J.C. Watts forced to go out of the ballgame for at least one play, Mike Hollensey, the backup quarterback, will come in. And he did not have any opportunity to get loose over at that Ottawa bench. As a matter of fact, the moment J.C. Watts went down, he had to run over there and grab a football and start throwing. He comes into the ballgame. Troy Boldin had been the backup for the Ottawa Rough Riders earlier in the year, but they activated Hollensey for this ballgame. And he has seen action with a couple of teams this season, the most recent being the Toronto Argonauts.
Man, J.C. Watt better get ready, because if they don't make it on second, they've got to go on third.
Quarterback draw. And Hollensey fumbled the football. Montreal claim they've got it. The play had been whistled
dead. Well, I'm not too sure about that call, Ron, although Hollensey was cold and maybe he just didn't feel that he had the ability to throw the ball with any degree of accuracy, being cold from coming off the sidelines, but he certainly wasn't going to do much with that play.
No, that's not much that call at all. I agree. He was down when the ball was fumbled. Here's what I don't understand. Throw the foot. J.C., get in there and throw the ball. Quit messing around. We're going to kick it.
By Phil Jones at his 25. Jones finds a bit of a hole and gets out to the 39-yard line. A 39-yard kick by Ken Clark and a run back of 6 yards by Phil Jones. He was stopped by Ron Engelson. Well, Gary Durchick with a perfect record as a head coach of the Montreal Concordes, winning the only two games in which he directed traffic from behind the bench, and it looks very much with 6:14 remaining that he'll make it 3-for-3.
Well, the team's playing with so much confidence now, especially at that quarterback position where it's most important. I think everything's under control.
Hand off to Alan Reed, and he fumbles the football. It's recovered by Trevor Bowles, who takes it out of bounds, and everything is going Montreal's way.
Trevor Bowles is about 6'14", weighs about 265 pounds, but he handled that ball like a halfback. As you say, Don, he got it on the first bounce. It could have very well been bounced into Ottawa's hands, and it could have given them another shot. See the ball come loose there. Trevor Bowles, number 67, scoops it up. Looks like he's had it in his hand before. Maybe he's been a basketball player with his size.
So despite the fumble, it's a gain of 8 yards. We'll make it 7 yards. It's second and three. It's fumbled again, and this time Joe Barnes gets the ball. As I said, when things are going your way, it seems they just continue to roll along.
Looking back, I'm trying to think just now where I thought like a turning point was, and the only thing I can come up with is J.C. Watts was going along pretty good, and when he threw the interception to Paul Gray, from that point on, he just hasn't moved the football.
Did you see Gary Dirchick there on the sidelines? He's just taken over this job a couple weeks ago, but he showed a little emotion there. And sometime in the press conference the other day, they were mentioning that both of these coaches are emotional coaches, and Dirchick didn't look very emotional in that press conference, but he showed a little bit of emotion here, and I think he told his quarterback, let's keep the ball on the ground and don't take any chances of throwing it around like that.
McTagg's third down punt to Stu Fraser. They're running the reverse with Catterbone, but Montreal was ready for it. Aaron Hill dropped Catterbone with an excellent open field tackle.
I look down on the bench. I see Mark Stevens warming up down there for Concordes. Maybe he's going to get a chance to play today. I think it's good. It's a good time. I don't think they're in too much danger right now. We're 30-13 lead.
J.C. Watts is going back in the ball game, so they're going to fire their best shot with the 5:03 left in the game.
Way that Aaron Hill and several of those Montreal punt coverage people got downfield, you'd almost think they were looking at that Ottawa playbook. They seem to be ready for that one.
Well, you know they were warned. Ottawa's run it before, so you're going to be warned about that. Stay home.
J.C. Watts back in at quarterback for Ottawa. He got away from Brett Williams, throws deep at Jemison. Made the catch, and Aaron Hill the hit, but Jemison was able to hang on.
Give him full marks for this reception because Aaron Hill stuck him just as he caught the ball and turned. Aaron Hill was there to really level him.
Boy, those are the kind that are really smart, too, because you usually get them in the back or in the kidney area or someplace, and it's very easy to forget about that football and let it go.
There's the throw. Watch this catch, and watch the hit. Bang, there he is. See that head pop back? You know he took a good hit.
Well, the truth is said that someone just said recently, getting a hit like that and letting that ball go is something like being out in traffic with a bottle of milk and having getting hit by a car, and all of a sudden the milk isn't very important to you anymore.
You talked about turning points in this ball game. In one of our commercial breaks, I think you may have hit the nail on the head when you said the turning point occurred last weekend.
Yeah, Ottawa had a tough week last weekend. You know, they went out to BC and they played the Lions a heck of a football game, and you know, they had the opportunity to finish first at that time, and they lose to the Lions, and then they wanted home field advantage and, you know, finishing second, and Montreal up and beats Edmonton, so they go from first to second and third, and as you mentioned, and then Joe gets fined $2,000 for the week. It was a tough couple days for the Ottawa Rough Riders.
As you pointed out earlier, Stevens is warming up at that Montreal bench, so we may see the young quarterback in the final minutes of the ball game. Catterbone was the intended receiver. The throw just a little high, and it falls incomplete. Well, that's what Gary Dirchick said yesterday at the press conference regarding his backup quarterbacks, Jerry DiTillio with the experience, Stevens with the mobility. So they don't want to risk any further injury to Joe Barnes, the man that is a key if they're to advance beyond the Eastern Championship. So I think we're going to see Stevens. J.C. Watts is in trouble again, being chased by Rocky. He gets the throw away, incomplete. It was intended for Tim McCray.
Well, they just can't handle the Montreal rush right now, but I know this. It's time to give Joe Barnes a rest. He did what was expected of him today, and something that they've been wanting to do since they obtained him from the Calgary Stampeders. He's come in and provided leadership, and we saw that statistic on the screen a little while ago, 26 first downs, and it proves once again what we said. First down, CA touchdown.
Ron, it's the score, as we look up on the scoreboard, 30-13. Third down here, why not go for it?
Third down kick taken by Phil Jones at the 10-yard line. And he is stopped at the 20. A 47-yard kick that time by Ken Clark.
Well, while we're waiting right here, this program is copyrighted and is strictly for the private use of our audience. Any reproduction, retransmission, or exhibition in whole or in part without the express written consent of the Canadian Broadcasting Corporation is strictly prohibited.
Decided with that ball deep in his own zone at the 20-yard line, he better go to the experienced quarterback.
And the guy
with the man who has them in this 30-13 lead.
Yeah, I think that's a good play at this part, Don. Plus the fact that Joe is warmed up, too, and his hands are warm and the whole thing. And as you say, down at that stage right there, if they fumble the football, it could be very, very dangerous in this stage of the football game. And we'll be back in just a moment.
Second and 10, Montreal at the 20-yard line. I think it's safe to assume that Barnes might be handing off again on this play. No, he's going to throw it. A sideline pattern intended for McTagg, incomplete. Now it's third and 10. I thought that with Barnes continuing in the ball game, deep in his own zone, he would hand off to either Reed or Johns and use up some time.
That's when the confidence factor comes in. He's played so well today. Joe probably feels he can do anything right now. Why not take the chance? And he didn't like what he saw. He threw it out of bounds.
I'll tell you, I don't care how good he is or how well he's played or anything else. Had he thrown that ball 5 yards away from somebody over there on the defense, I'd agree with you. But it was too close to that defender to throw the ball, and it was ill-advised to put the ball in the air at this stage of the ball game.
Well, I know. We're not going to agree on that.
Takes that third down punt by McTagg and is stopped at the 45-yard line. And J.C. Watts, who was shaken up earlier in the ball game, will continue to direct the attack for these final 2 minutes and 31 seconds.
And you can bet he's going to take a little more rough treatment from that Concord defense, because they know he's got to put it in the air, so they're going to be coming.
He throws to Tim McCray, and McCray is caught immediately by the middle linebacker, Paul Gray.
More another Montreal player is down out there on the field.
I believe it's Steve Rocky. He was coming from his outside position and got a hand on J.C. Watts just as he threw the football. But Rocky has been playing hurt throughout most of the season, and he may have aggravated an old injury.
You tell me I got to think like a quarterback. Now, I'm not present company denied. How many quarterbacks have ever made good football coaches?
All of them. All of them. Steve Rocky kind of just fell on J.C. Watts' foot was there, and I'm just trying to figure out where he was hurt. I would say he's probably hurt up in the shoulder and up in the rib area. What was his injury before? And he's had so many this year. It hasn't been a good year for him either. He's missed a lot of games because of injuries.
It looked like they were looking at his arm, and he's kind of carrying one arm a little bit loose, but he's trying to lift it up now, so it looks like a shoulder.
Well, he can rest now and get ready for next week.
That means that George Volk will come into the ball game, a product of the University of Saskatchewan. Rocky, 6'5", 240-pounder out of Holy Cross. Second down play, 4 yards to go. The defensive lineman.
team. J.C. Watt scrambling. There comes the one hit. Brett Williams has him, and the ball's knocked loose. And they rolled it dead right there. 3rd and 13. Why not throw?
1:49 is the time remaining. Watt's having problems finding a receiver, still on his feet. And technical people who help bring you CFL football all season long. Tim McRae into the end zone for the touchdown. And that comes with 46 seconds remaining.
Well, Ottawa scored the first touchdown of the game. It looks like they're going to score the last one, because with 46 seconds left, Montreal will be very content. Just watch those 46 seconds go away.
Would you say that we've set the stage here for a good possibility of an onside kick?
I think the possibility is there. I'm interested to see whether Montreal decides to receive a kickoff.
Well, not having someone to kick the ball deep, I think they might decide to receive. Penalty flag. Violation against the Ottawa Rough Riders. Apparently the problem as far as Ottawa was concerned is that Ken Clark had lined up too close to the line of scrimmage.
Nine count violation. Ottawa number two.
In preparing to spot the ball for the point after. He was a little too close, and Dean Dorsey wanted him to move that kicking tee back.
I always thought the kicker spotted him. He puts the tee down or whatever it is where he wants it.
This time Dorsey puts it through. Point after, and it's now 30-20. Montreal in front.
I think maybe I have to.
Well, Joel Barnes, who has had an outstanding ball game as the quarterback of the Montreal Concordes, has been chosen our Carling O'Keefe offensive game star. Man, number 42, middle linebacker Paul Gray, is our Carling O'Keefe defensive game star.
Well, I'm really happy for Joe Barnes. He's had a tough year. He was in Calgary and they had their problems there. He came over here at the time when Montreal was on that downward slide and didn't get the things going his way, picked up a couple injuries, but he came back at the right time. And this is the time, as you said earlier, Leo, it's time to peak, and he might be doing it now, because next week it'll be a great one in Hamilton.
Well, in anticipation of an onside kick, Vince Faison is the lone deep back for Montreal, and he has only gone back to his own 10-yard line. At one point, he was at the 20-yard line. It's a short kick, and Araki touches the ball, but has Ottawa recovered?
The official certainly indicated.
Yes, the Ottawa Rough Riders have recovered. That ball traveled 12 yards, and it only had to go 10, of course. Araki fielded that ball rather casually.
What I didn't like about it is he waited for the ball to come to him instead of going to the football, and with his height, he could probably go up a little bit higher, but as you said, they're a little casual, and as a result, Ottawa's got the football back.
Well, the Carling O'Keefe Sports Game Stars, Joe Barnes and Paul Gray, will receive a portable stereo system from Citizen Electronics for being honored in this semifinal game. Fights his way to the 35-yard line with 37 seconds remaining.
JC should be up there calling his play, because that clock's going to start as soon as that referee walks away. There it goes.
From the 35, first down, Ottawa. JC Watt flipping it out to Tim McRae. McRae is stopped short of the first down by Paul Gray. 22 seconds remain.
He had to go to the end zone for that ball. He can't afford to throw it short.
Well, many of the same people who have helped bring you this afternoon's semifinal game will be working on our Grey Cup coverage from Olympic Stadium on the 24th of November. And next Sunday, our production crew will be out in Vancouver for that Western Final. The BC Lions against either Edmonton or Winnipeg. Pass over the middle, incomplete. Big hit again on Mike Catterbone. There were three Montreal defensive backs there to apply the hit.
football. The ball was thrown in there about as well as you can throw it, but a good hit. The ball came out.
Just 12 seconds remaining. 30-20. Montreal leads, and next Sunday afternoon, the Hamilton Tiger Cats will be entertaining the Montreal Concordes in the Eastern Final. The throw is incomplete. That was the third down pass. J.C. Watt looking over the middle, and with just 7 seconds remaining, this ball game is now officially over, although I think it's been over for just about the last 15 minutes with the Montreal Concordes in control.
Actually, the only thing I think that the Concordes did a little shabbily in this last quarter was, as you said, Don, the way that they reacted to that onside kick. It was a little lackadaisical, it was a little dangerous on their part. Other than that, they've played well offensively and defensively and really have taken it away from the Ottawa Rough Riders.
Well, they deserve full marks for the effort today. We said earlier in the year, after seeing them in some of their games, that they were going to have problems the rest of the year, but they have bounced back and bounced back well.
However, they will be a bruised football team for that Eastern Final against Hamilton. Barnes simply drops to one knee. That used up 1 second, but now the clock will start as the official, Ross Perrier, the referee, moves away from the ball. And this one will go into the books as a 30-20 Eastern semifinal win for the Montreal Concordes over the Ottawa Rough Riders. The third straight win for Gary.
Coming through with a 30-20 victory over the Ottawa Rough Riders, so that sends Montreal to Hamilton next Sunday for the Eastern Division Final in a game that you'll see on the full CTV network, the Tiger Cats against the Concordes. And how about that Gary Dirchuk, since taking over from Joe Gallant as head coach, the Concordes are unbeaten with Dirchuk at the controls.
Starting defense for the Edmonton Eskimos, number 91 at left end, Andre Pinesett. Number 75, a defensive tackle, John Mandrich. Number 92, a defensive tackle, James Zachary. Number 95 at right end, Dan Kearns. Number 43 at linebacker, Craig Schaefer. Number 30 at linebacker, Danny Bass. Number 36 at linebacker, Stuart Hill. Number 24 at cornerback, Darrell Hall. Number 17 at defensive halfback, James Bell. Number 15 at safety, Laurent Delaurier. Number 28, defensive halfback, Ron Howard. And number 5 at cornerback, Mark Jackson. Head coach, Jackie Parker, and the rest of the Edmonton Eskimos. Number 65 at left guard, Nick Bastia. Number 50 at right guard, Mark Lewis. Number 62 at left tackle, Richard Nemeth. Number 63 at right tackle, Chris Walby. Number 29 at slot back, Jerome Erdman. Number 71 at slot back, Joe Poposky. Number 21 at wide receiver, James Murphy. Number 70, wide receiver, Jeff Boyd. Number 39 at running back, Sean Kehoe. Number 38 at running back, Willard Reed. And number 2 at quarterback, Tom Clemens. Coach Fred Glick and the rest of the Winnipeg Blue Bombers.
All right, this crowd is ready for playoff football action in Winnipeg, and we'll be right back with the opening kickoff in just a moment. Lorne Woods is the head referee for this afternoon's Western Division semifinal, and he'll be helped out today by Chuck Paul, Ross Saunders, Art McAvoy, Larry Rohan, and Brian Donnelly. Brilliant sunshine here in Winnipeg this afternoon on a cold day, although it's not as cold as we were told it might be. Because there isn't a lot of wind, it certainly helps the situation, Frank.
Bill, the field is in absolutely excellent condition. However, the Winnipeg Blue Bombers staff has not put heat on the field because they found last year underneath the tarpaulin that it tend to freeze the field when they took it off. So it has been covered for the last 3 or 4 days and is in excellent condition, as good as you could possibly expect at this time of the year in Winnipeg.
Well, these Eskimos defeated the Bombers twice during the regular season. You know, back in July, the Bombers really weren't in top form, and the Eskimos beat them up in Edmonton in a very close ball game, 25-23. But then I guess the story in the second game is the fact Tom Clemens, you know, and the Bombers were just kind of on a downer after beating BC twice. They played hard, but they didn't play well.
Well, the other thing, of course, Damon Allen took off with the football so many times and so successfully, gained 150 yards rushing from that quarterback spot. So obviously the Eskimos at that point in time did not miss Matt Dunnigan, but they definitely will miss his experience somewhat this afternoon. We'll see just how much.
I've covered football, I don't think I've seen a team experience as many injuries as the Eskimos have in 1985. These are just first-string players that are missing today. From the offense, you noticed a few, but from the defense, look at that. 2-8, the most recent to go down, along with Murphy, Daly, Thompson, Tony, and Holloman. So believe me, the Eskimos go into this one in very, very tough.
2-8 isn't playing. It was just revealed yesterday he suffered an injury in there. Regular season finale last weekend in Montreal, and the injury to his ankle just never responded to treatment. In fact, Jack Parker said it just got worse as the week wore on.
Well, Dale, in addition to that, James Zachary, who's had just an outstanding last half of 1985, is playing with a broken bone in his foot. They're not sure exactly how long he'll last, so they're very, very thin at defensive line position.
The Eskimos will get the ball first. Chris Woods has it bounced by him at the 10-yard line, and he'll step out of bounds at the 9. So the Eskimos will have to start deep in their own zone. A 57-yard kickoff and a return of 1. So it's the rookie Damon Allen leading the Eskimo offense to the field. Larry Cowan and Milson Jones, who's also hurting, as the starting running backs. Wide receivers, Chris